They're in physics working group of the IPA, who's done a lot in this course, and several other people who've been working for this course. So I especially like the title, which says Pressing for Progress. So it's about time we do just that. Today, Google is celebrating the birthday of Katsuko Saruhashi. And that's her 98th birthday today. And she has fought this relentless battle for having equal numbers of women in science. And today I just did a rough check of two institutions, which we all know, but which I won't name. And the ratio is less than 10% in the physics department faculty. So obviously we have a very long way to go, although someone who was born in 1920 had started working for this. Incidentally, she made like amazing discoveries. Like one of them, which was very important, was we should not do nuclear tests in the ocean because radiation gets spread all over the globe. And she's made a lot of very important such things. So she was an environmentalist before her time. So with that, I welcome you all again. And I call Prajval to the podium here because she will now read out a message from the president of the IP.
Good afternoon, everyone. Let me add my voice of welcome to all of you. It is extremely heartening to have all of you here because it really symbolizes a felt concern to transform our profession into a better one and to bring insights from tackling inequity elsewhere into our profession. So the proceedings are also being streamed live via YouTube, and I welcome all of those who are remotely connected to us as well. We have our colleagues who will be monitoring any messages that you might send on chat. In fact, please do send us a brief message with your name and where you're listening from and how many of you, just so we know. So I speak on behalf of all the members of the Gender and Physics Working Group of the Indian Physics Association when I say that we're all extremely grateful that so many people who were part of this process right from the beginning, which has brought us to this moment, are here with us. But there are some important people who are missing. One of them who had to pull out at the last minute is Dr. Dinakar Kanjilal, president of the Indian Physics Association, or IPA, who is also director of the Inter-University Accelerator, which is on the JNU campus in Delhi. Dr. Kanjilal has been a pillar of support in the whole process that has brought us to this moment. He has always given us his time, despite his busy schedule as a director. If it is not clear to you already, it will become clear at the end of this session as to how important it is that people who are leaders of institutions be engaged with this question. And we have to make do, unfortunately, with just reading out a message from Dr. Kanjilal. He says, "Dear participants, I'm very sorry for my inability to participate in the discussion meeting on the gender gap in physics organized at the International Center for Theoretical Sciences by Professor Prajval Shastri, the chair of the Gender and Physics Working Group of the IPA. All activities of physics should always be open to all human beings, regardless of their gender. Women are underrepresented at all levels of physics, both in India and worldwide. However, women comprise about half the workforce and should have appropriate representation for better harmony and for faster development of the nation. I hope that the discussion meeting will give an opportunity to the participants to share their views very clearly, which may subsequently enable a shift in the development of better identity for women in physics. Thanking you, and with best wishes, Dinakar Kanjilal." So this is the first event that we, as a working group, are organizing. It all started, in some sense, a very long time ago with the International Union of Pure and Applied Physics, which is the sort of global professional organization of physicists. constituting a working group on women in physics around about 2000. Their main mandate was to conduct conferences every 3 years, the international conferences for women in physics, about which Professor Reshmi Lakshmi will talk more later. They got funding for these conferences, and these were meant to be crucibles of ideas for change in the profession that was clearly ridden with gender discrimination. India has been a very active participant right from the beginning in these conferences with Professors Roni Godbole, Neelima Gupte, Sumati Rao, who hopefully is on the remote link, Anita Mehta, Shobhana Narasimhan. We're all involved very actively. So I went to the first such conference in 2011 in Cape Town as the country team leader, and participating in one of the major components of the conference, which was workshops to come up with recommendations for the profession worldwide, which then translated into resolutions and then were taken back to the respective countries. I found that every country had its own physics working group on gender in physics. It had a professional physics society, which was a forum for discussion, a vibrant discussion, and they had a gender working group. But we had none. On paper, the Indian National Science Academy is the liaison for the IUPAP. And of course, INSA has been very supportive in supporting, giving funding for participants to participate in these conferences. But they neither have the mechanism nor the bandwidth to engage with the specificities of these questions, with the real questions that plague our discipline, and do something about it, which is not very surprising because it's not necessarily a representative body. I was again team leader in the 2014 conference, and we still had nothing in terms of a national working group. Over the subsequent months, a bunch of us agreed that the right society under which to constitute such a working group was the Indian Physics Association. It is a dues-paying, membership-based professional physics society, and therefore inclusive. It is a member of the Asia-Pacific Consortium of Physical Societies. It has official sister relationships with the British Society and the American one. So on Women's Day of 2016, it so happened, a proposal was made, and is the slide up there? So the slide will show the people who... So this proposal got accepted sometime last year, and in May 2017, our working group got set up. All but one of them is here, and you will hear from them. In this context, I want to read out a message that the current chair of the IUPAP Working Group on Women in Physics, Dr. Gillian Butcher from Britain, has sent. So she says, as the chair of the IUPAP Working Group on Women in Physics, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to be able to congratulate you on reaching this point of launching the Gender in Physics Working Group of the IPA. These things don't just happen, but require much effort and time to organize with a great deal of groundwork necessary. Of course, the work doesn't stop here. This is just the beginning of a new chapter, which, with the commitment and enthusiasm already shown, is sure to lead to progress for women in physics in India. It's almost 20 years since IUPAP set up their own working group on women in physics to address the gender gap globally. In that time, and 6 international conferences later, much progress has been made in ways that perhaps may not have been foreseen. Those of us fortunate enough to have been involved in women in physics networks at local, national, or international level know how important the support of these networks is. There is the support of each other, the sharing of experience, and the collective strength to endeavor to make change. India, having been well represented at the EQIP conferences and on the IUPAP working group, is very much a part of that international network. And so we, as an international community of physicists and friends, share in the joy and excitement of your new working group and wish you well for today's event and for the future. So that is Gillian Butcher at Leicester. So I put this photograph as well. One thing I want to mention is that during the brainstorming that led to this proposal to constitute the working group, one idea that bubbled up among those of us who were brainstorming was that we would bring out three Indian science publications with an all-women authorship. And these actually came out last year. One was Resonance, which is an undergraduate magazine for adult science buffs published by the Indian Academy of Sciences. The other was Physics News, which is, in fact, the magazine of the Indian Physics Association. And the third was the was a special issue of Current Science. So Current Science was edited by Professor Neelima Gupte and Professor Sulabha Kulkarni, who are both here today. Physics News was edited by me and Bindu Bamba and Vandana Nanal. Bindu is here. And Resonance was by me and a biologist colleague from Delhi. The intent was, at least that was our intent, not to showcase women's work. It was to demonstrate that it is quite ordinary and quite regular for women to do all the professional work that men do, including writing for a range of audiences, a general physics audience, an undergraduate level adult audience, science buffs, and a general research audience in the case of Current Science. The fraction of women authors was only 15%. Slide there. It was only 15% for Resonance, which is all of science, and it was a maximum of 10% and often 0% for Physics News before these special issues, which clearly showed that when the editorial board is thinking scientist, they're only thinking male scientist. And the message that we were trying to get across is that editorial boards of such magazines have a duty and a responsibility to project the idea that everybody, regardless of gender, is equally capable of being a scientist and a science writer. Whereas what they were actually doing was the opposite. They were only mirroring the patriarchy in society as a whole. So some of the authors are here in the audience, Rama Govindarajan, Roni Godbole, Bindu Bamba. And mind you, these authors were taking a serious risk because a typical professional ambience looks down upon women who work towards gender equity as wanting to just get favors for themselves. And they become vulnerable to the quality of their work being questioned. So we basically answered the question, is there a shortage of women who can competently write science articles? And the answer, of course, is no. And incidentally, one more such special issue of Resonance is just out this month, edited by physicist Pratibha Jolly, who's also the principal of Miranda House in Delhi. So while we listen to the subsequent talks, there are a few things that I suggest we be mindful about. The profession has not found it easy to acknowledge that there is a gender bias within the profession. But the government has, and has pumped in significant amounts of funding to rectify the problem. However, most people's response to why there is a gender gap is that it is because of the discriminatory familial responsibilities that women face in society. In fact, most often, it is not even seen as a discriminatory responsibility. This patriarchal mindset, and by patriarchy, I mean institutionalized sexism, plagues the interventions rather heavily. You just have to read the text on the webpage of the mobility scheme that the Department of Science and Technology is considering. So most interventions adopt the course of fixing the women, increasing their skills, their confidence, all that. But there is no evidence that has been presented which demonstrates that women preferentially lack skills. The evidence is actually the opposite, that there is no productivity deficit, for example, the study of Neelam Kumar many years ago, that there is no caliber deficit, the study by Subramaniam many years ago. There is also no evidence that girls are less interested in science. We've shown evidence to the contrary in our papers at the EQIP conferences. And while discriminatory familial responsibilities does appear to be a factor, it is not the whole story. There is significant evidence, and not just anecdotal, that there is severe bias within the profession. And biology, for example, has a lower gender gap than physics, which cannot be attributed to discriminatory familial responsibilities. It is therefore extremely important to actively learn from the insights that social scientists present before us and to collaborate with them. It is extremely important to internalize that gender is a social construct, not given to us by nature, but created by society. Professor Anita Kurup, I hope she's here yet. Okay, she's supposed to be on the way, hopefully. A sociologist from NIAS, led a very large study a few years ago, commissioned by the Indian Academy of Sciences in collaboration with Rohini Godbole and others, titled Trained Scientific Women Power, How Much Are We Losing and Why? With some very powerful insights. I particularly want to stress this, and this idea of taking insights from social sciences and collaborating with them, because traditional physicists, particularly those trained in India, we are trained to think that we understand the whole universe and we don't need anybody else's insights on any matter. Again, Anita Kurup hopefully will be here soon and we'll hear more from her. In that context, and I'm quoting bell hooks here, it is important to be mindful that right from birth, all of us, whether men or women, are socialized to accept sexist thought and sexist action. So while the benefits of sexism might preferentially go to the men, all of us are sexist to some extent or another, and therefore change demands that we be mindful and we transform ourselves. Maitri Gopalakrishna, who's more of an expert in that field, will also talk to us today. I also want to mention, that's the cover page of the two special issues. Unfortunately, I didn't have the current science special issue cover with me. This is the study I mentioned by Kurup, Godbole and others. So I want to mention the Global Gender Gap Project by the International Council of Science, which has just been sanctioned. So the International Council of Science is a non-governmental organization with a global membership of national bodies and the international scientific unions as well. This is a project funded by ICSU with the collaboration of several of the unions, including physics, mathematics, chemistry, astronomy, history and philosophy of science, and so forth. And it is titled A Global Approach to the Gender Gap in Mathematical and Natural Sciences, How to Measure It, How to Reduce It. So it has set itself three tasks: a joint global survey, a data-backed study on publications, and creating a database of good practices. So the first one, the joint global survey, has begun. So I attended a workshop in Taipei a few months ago, which was meant to vet the survey among people of different countries. The survey is sort of a building up on the global physics survey, which happened a few years ago, and some of you might have been respondents to that survey. And so this one is going to be translated into many languages internationally. Because of the process involved, hopefully the cultural aspects of different countries have been accounted for. And it is expected to come out in a few months. So the physicists in this audience or other scientists, you might get information about the survey. Please make sure that you give it wide publicity and respond to it. Because the response from the physics community to the gender gap in physics, global gender gap survey in physics a few years ago, was not that great from India. So, someone has said that the philosophers have only interpreted the world in various ways. The point, however, is to change it. Whose quote that is a homework problem. But we are here today to debate about how to change our world, our little world, the physics profession in India. We, as a working group of the Indian Physics Association, are here with the goal to dissolve the working group by making it irrelevant. It is not clear that that day will arrive in our lifetimes or in my lifetime, but we do believe that it will arrive. So that brings me to the mention of a second important person missing today, because she had to go off to Chennai for an important meeting. This is Vandana Nanal, Fundamental Research, who's also a member of the Gender in Physics Working Group as ex officio member of the Executive Council of the IPA. So I'm going to show you her slides. So she says, she asked the question, what to expect from the IPA. So the IPA is a national forum. The IPA also co-organizes conferences, arranges lectures by eminent scientists, hosts special awards for significant achievements in recognition of important national contributions, liaises with other international organizations such as the Institute of Physics of the UK and the AAPPS, the Association of Asia-Pacific Physical Societies, offers a wider platform for discussion and addressing of gender issues. The main concern is poor representation of women scientists in the IPA decision making or IPA lectures and awards. So we have made a start with the Gender and Physics Working Group. In fact, thanks to Vandana Nanal's participation, the IPA C.V. Raman lectures, which happen around, four of them happen every year, has increased its gender fraction very significantly. So it used to be that Rohini Godbole was the only woman speaker. And by the way, that's an interesting idea. I mean, there is Rohini Godbole, the person, but there is also Rohini Godbole, this concept. And you know, you ask people, you know, why is there such a poor representation? They say, oh, but Rohini Godbole has spoken. And if there is no representation, they say, but we asked Rohini, and she said no. And so, you know, that is the end of the matter. So if they have asked Rohini whether she says yes or no, they have done their job in terms of bringing women representation into anything. So that changed last year, and Professor Bamba, Gupte, and Kulkarni gave the Raman lectures last year. So that's a huge increase in the diversity. So Vandana says the next few steps, mobilize the gender issues at the chapter level. Identify chapter representatives, establish a wider council or group which will interact with the working group, enhance participation of women scientists in various IPA activities, and ensure proper representation in the IPA executive committee, amendments to the bylaws if needed. Each chapter should be encouraged to host at least one annual event addressing gender issues. So I'll stop there. With that, I've finished both my presentation and Vandana Nanal's. So we will now have Professor Rashmi Lakshmi from the IIST in Thiruvananthapuram. She's an astrophysicist and also a member of the Gender and Physics Working Group. She has been country team leader. She has been country team member in the 2014 International Conference on Women in Physics and team leader for the last one, which happened in Birmingham last year. And she will talk to us about the International Conferences on Women in Physics. Rashmi.
Thank you, Professor Shastri. Am I audible? It is warm. Thank you, Professor Shastri. I'll be, as she mentioned, I was a member of the Indian country team for the two international conferences on women in physics. So I'll briefly cover what these conferences are and what are my experiences during this. Okay, so the ICWIP is they started as a when the IUPAP started a resolution in General Assembly in 1999 to create a working group for which is called Working Group 5. We have seen the we have heard the message from Professor Butcher, who is the current chair of the working group. The group's was used to survey the present situation of gender in physics and report it to IUPAP Council and to suggest the means to improve the status of women in physics in the member countries. These conferences began in 2002 after the report was submitted, and it's once in every 3 years, and the sixth edition is what happened in 2017 in Birmingham, and the one before that where I was the first time the country team member was in 2014 in Canada. So these conferences are somewhat slightly different from the normal science physics conferences that we are used to. Here, a country team represents the country and reports the activities and the status of gender in physics in the country and reports the activities and the kind of measures that has been taken to improve the status. The team will have a team leader who does all the coordination and presents the poster and the country there will be a poster which lists all this, the status of the gender and the activities that has been taken, and which is also will be coming out as a, which will also will come out as a proceedings. So the team typically can consist of 5 to 6 members, mostly women scientists, physicists, and sometimes social scientists, and there are also male scientists are also in strongly encouraged to be part of the team. And the liaison committee is then expected to implement the resolutions and recommendations that are given to IUPAP at the end of the conference. So this is the country team in 2014, which was headed, the team leader was Prajval. And there was Professor Seema Ubale from MPD Science College, Nagpur, Shrabona Bakshi from HRA, who's a graduate student, and Professor Anita Kurpa, who is already here, from NIAS Bangalore, who is a social scientist, and myself. In 2017, this was our team. Our team was team was these many people, along with Prajwal, who joined as the working group member. In both years, our efforts to get a male physicist in the team did not quite succeed. All the team members except Professor Urvashi Sinha from RRA, everybody is here, and they will be talking after me. So just to give you a flavor of what actually happens in these conferences, I just tell you some of the highlights. In 2017 Birmingham conference, there were 6 invited talks that ranged from gravitational wave physics to nanostructures, or from biophysics to quantum technologies. And in these invited talks, which go for almost an hour, the speaker will not only speak about their research, but also will speak about their personal experience, their journey as a scientist. And that is many times very insightful. And I remember this very well, this talk in 2014. It's one of the invited talks by Professor Melissa Franklin, who's the chair of the Harvard University Physics Department then. And it was one of the most innovative talks I have heard, where she spoke about the concept of the space, the lab, and how she had to fight for lab space, and how she found her lab space being gone, and then how the lab space is so central to one's existence as a scientist, how important it is for independent thinking. And there was it also gave for example to me a feeling how even a Harvard professor, I didn't have that sort of an idea how it will be for indifferent people, what kind of gender related discrimination or whatever is being faced. In 2017, one of the talks which I found very insightful is Professor Maria Teresa Lago from Portugal, who had played a major role in building the astronomy career and research and education in Portugal, who spoke about various statistics in CERN, in ESO, in IAU, etc. She also presented for this CSER figure, which is a very well-known figure, which shows how the percentage of women reduces as the stage increases. This is from the EU data. So it shows the starting at this at the other end is the students, and over here that is the towards here this will be the professors. So there are 2 years. The green is the bluish green is men in 2013 and 2007, and the orange is the women. So it shows how the shows the statistics is being taken very regularly, and one can really look at it how it is evolving. So she, Professor Lago had her thought was that achieving gender balance is too slow, and she said that it's probably require a different thought on how to improve the gender balance. In addition to these talks, there were also gender workshops, and these are very central to the entire program. These will go on for 2 to 3 days in the afternoons. In both the years, there were workshops in broadly in these five areas. In the 2017 workshop, Prajval was a co-organizer of the gender studies and intersectionality, and I had attended the improving workspace and workplace and science practice in 2014, and in 2017 I attended the professional development and leadership workshop, and there were the current other team members in 2017 attended different other workshop, and I'm sure they will talk to you about in detail about their experiences in this. It is in 2014 in this workplace, improving workplace workshop that I learned about the junior program in UK, which is a very highly successful one, an institutionalized program to improve the gender gap, improve the statistics, which was pretty new, and that the government itself will take a lot of effort to increase the numbers, and the incentive is money. So in 2017, I attended the leadership training and professional development workshop, and it was also quite an interesting one. First there was a hypothetical story about a dean who is having problems make others listen to her, etc. So the question asked is that how do you think the dean could improve her ways of operations, or how she can learn to do things better? And what I learned there is that several other members who attended the workshop with me, they have all attended something of this sort in past. So one thing I particularly noticed is that in India there is hardly any such training or like leadership training or training to against implicit bias, etc., which is very common in other countries. So when it comes to 2017 ICWP, there were additional workshops, and most of us Indian team members attended the unconscious bias one. I guess one of our team members will speak about it, so I'm not really going much into this. In addition to workshops and talks, there were also art installations celebrating women diversity in physics, for example. And just to give you a highlight of the country paper of 2017, so as I said, there is a country paper and poster that was co-authored by the team members. In addition to that, there were a few more authors. Some of them are already here in the audience. The proceedings are currently in print. So we presented the statistics of gender gap in India that we collected. For example, this is the number of male and female faculty in tenure positions in different research and teaching plus research institutions in India. And you can clearly see the gap over here. There's no need to say anything more about this in the graph itself. It's clear. I was discussing with one of the colleagues from US who looked at some of the institutions and said that the number is zero. And if they were really care, I mean, she had a comment that if they really cared about diversity, they would have at least asked a senior professor to move. They would try to get somebody. So many times some of the institutions say that we didn't get anybody who was there. So, yeah. So then we here is the donor diagram that shows the percentage of women in tenure positions, which is around 20% this is the entire pool, including research institutions, teaching universities, etc. And when we look at the statistics of DST EMR, the core research grant proposal, it quotes reflects this pool of 20%. There is around 20% of applicants, and if you, the inner circle is the proposals received during 2015 and 17. In that period, around 20% of the applicants were women, and the sanctioned one is the outer circle, that is around 23%. So this shows that DST grants are sort of reflecting the pool that is already available, which is a good thing. But when it comes to some sort of a prestigious fellowships, or then you see things starting to change. For example, the fellows in physics and Indian Academy of Sciences is less than 10%. Then these are governing council members of 14 research institutions mainly that we collected, the science members who are scientists, and there are only 3 out of the total 86 who are women. This was what we presented in our country team paper, that that time in the IPS Raman lectures, which is already being mentioned here, there was only 1 out of 25 speakers were women. But in the last 1 year, the number has improved, I understand. So after that, our poster also covered the measures taken in past 3 years, which is already being mentioned by Professor Shastri, which is the included the mention about the different special editions. We also talked about the creation of the working group for gender equity in the Astronomical Society of India, the working group on IPA, and the DST's National Standing Committee for Promoting Women in Science. And there are several events in the International Women's Day. For example, this picture is from PRL, where they conducted open school, the International Women's Day, with school children coming and looking at the poster. I'll end by mentioning the measures taken by other countries, just for a comparison as what we could do. For example, one of the things which I particularly noticed is the price study, which is run by Harvard, where this is questions that is asked to girls and women, with explicit discussion of underrepresentation of women in science at the biggest impact of strengthening physics identity. Young girls see that the problem is in the society and not in them. This is something where I personally can very well relate to, because I personally feel the 2014 and 17 workshops, conferences that I attended, have particularly helped me to improve my confidence, and this is exactly what I also felt, that I started to understand different problems and started to realize that some of the problems are not which I thought is in me, and that's not the way to look into it, and how to understand several say imposter syndrome or implicit bias, which are things which I had or encountered. And that realization had really helped me in my own career. There are other national government programs, for example, Athena's one in UK, and SAGE, both are very similar. That's the SAGE in Australia. They believe in 10 principles, that the basic principle is that academia can achieve its highest potential only if every section is going to benefit from that. And based on these principles, they go ahead to create a general friendly, diversity friendly environment, and there is institutional support for improving the workplace equity. The Gender in Physics Days in Europe is again to participate, improve the participation of girls starting from the undergraduate level in STEM. So I have just collected a few examples from countries that we think are very advanced, very progressed, where that's the impression we have. But even those countries are still struggling, still trying their best to improve the status of women. So we have probably a long way to go, and I hope the working group can really move forward from here.
We'll have a few questions. We were short of time, so I didn't ask for questions to my presentation, but you're welcome to ask questions for both and also from the remote people.
But I wanted to kind of, I don't have it with me right now, but I could show you people a plot, which in fact was shown once upon a time by EST secretary himself, which I thought was quite good, is that the various, I mean, though not specific to physics, EST has had women in science programs for 15 years now. And the fraction of projects by women has grown tremendously in that period. Normally, whenever I have thought about it, I have not given this information for our IUPAP reports or something, because that's not specific to physics. But since you are saying this, I should tell you that this is something that happened over 15 years, that a fraction of women written projects where women were PIs actually did grow up, and there was a direct correlation with the PST's scheme.
I just wanted to add that, in fact, both Rohini and Sulubha have been chairs of this committee over prolonged periods. So I think it will be good if they can provide data and it can go into the next report.
I said normally I was not giving this data for these reports because I thought that was not physics. I mean, that is the only point I'm making. But because in physics we have no such segregated data. Okay. This is now, but in general, this is going to really much
come. The other thing is that there's a lot of data in the earlier reports also. So a year by year comparison would have been nice. How things have changed.
So the year-by-year comparison plot was in the 2014 country report. Those data are in that report.
Onwards, every year, 2002, 2005, 2008.
Yeah, they're in that 2014 paper. Any other questions? Okay, let's move to the next speaker. So we have Professor Suchetana Chatterjee from the Physics Department in Presidency University. She's a member of the Gender and Physics Working Group, and she will talk about diversity and inclusion.
Thank you very much, Professor Shastri. Should I use this or? Okay. Hello, can people hear me?
Maybe I should have to put it a little bit up.
Hello. Okay, thank you very much, Professor Shastri. It's definitely a great honor for me to first become a member of the IPA, National Gender Working Group, and I'll try to see in what ways I and as a community we can contribute to, you know, decrease the gender gap that we have been talking about. So Professor Reshmi Lakshmi, she talked about the ICWIP meeting, and we saw this picture, and it was very inspiring to see and meet women physicists from all over the country, and the global enthusiasm. So it's the gender gap is a global problem in physics, and the global enthusiasm to solve these problems at different levels, because different countries have the best experience that I gained from the meeting was that different countries have different kinds of problem, yet the outcome is the same, that, you know, you just have less women gender representation, a very skewed gender representation in the discipline itself. Now, since I was a student and a postdoc in the US, so we used to have a lot of discussion groups and working group meeting, and there were a leader, you know, there are senior women professors, leaders in the field with whom I had a lot of discussions. And this is a very complex issue, and several of my colleagues already shared some issues and some are going to share more. But I thought that since I come also from an undergraduate institution, Presidency University, it's a university, so we teach both undergraduate and master student. students. I'll just focus on something that we have been discussing for a long time, even when I was a graduate student, about admission processes. So when people enter into the discipline, to the physics discipline as undergraduate students or graduate students, the admission process itself suffers from certain kind of bias. And that is one of the many complex reasons for which we suffer disparity in the gender representation in our discipline. Now, question is that why do we want, one of the reasons we want to decrease the gender gap is 50% of the population in this world are women. So we want our discipline to flourish in years, and we can't afford losing a large fraction of the talented, you know, talent pool that is lying around us. So that's one of the major reasons that we want to remove this gender gap, because we want the discipline itself to flourish, and we cannot include biases in our system, which actually excludes a large number of the talent just because we have bad practices in our discipline. So this is a fantastic picture, very inspiring picture to meet all these co-scientists and same like-minded people. And this is a typical picture in our presidency physics colloquium. And what I see, I'm sure all of you also see, that we can hardly find the women, right? All are young men sitting in the audience. And that's discouraging. I'll tell you why. I'm very sad. So this is some small statistics that I gathered. So this is presidency physics, UGPG. 14.6% of our students are women. This is Izar Mohali, BSMS 2017 batch, 21%, still better, doing much better than us. This is TIFR DTP, Department of Theoretical Physics. 2 out of the 34 grad students, this is a top physics program in the country, and only 6% of the graduate students are women. Okay, very, very upsetting number. Now, this is ICTS. I had to also give the ICTS data. You are also not doing well. Sorry for telling that, but only 3 out of 41. This is integrated PhD and PhD students combined. So only this percent are female students. Now, of course, to Sierra, sure.
The overall
sample is already. It's not, see, 116, 210. This might be small, but trend is clear. Trend is clear. Sorry.
So I had a request that we have the questions at the end of the talk, because this is being streamed and we want the questions also to be streamed through the mics and so on. So let's have the questions, if you don't mind, at the end.
Okay. So I'm mostly sharing also some of these are my personal experiences. Now, of course, the gender ratio of applicants needed to be seen. So we definitely did a study for presidency, and we found that depending on the year, 35 to 40% of the applicants were female, yet the ones who are admitted is half, less than half that fraction. This is unacceptable. And I don't have the statistics, but as far as my first-hand knowledge goes, you know, these places take students through this JS, JAM, TIFR entrance, all sorts of MCQ-based admission tests, and definitely the gender ratio of applicants in these tests is definitely greater than 6% or 7%. That I can totally say. I don't have the exact numbers. So this is disturbing and discouraging. Now, why such things are happening? It's just not at the entry level, very basic level. We saw the scissor plots that Professor Reshmi Lakshmi showed us. So it's even getting worse and worse. But just even at the entry level, the very basic level, this is the picture in some of the top places in the country, okay? And this is this beautiful picture of all my colleagues in the ICWIP meeting. This is our country poster. And so, as Professor Lakshmi also said, that we discuss any of the issues, and this is a complex issue, needs discussion and a lot of proactive measures. So the one that I want to highlight, which is very easy, which is a very streamlined one point, just one point among this complex set of issues, which I think would be very interesting and very useful for the audience here, because this is a top physics institution in the country, and I saw that the ratio, you folks are not doing well. Neither are we. Okay. So I will just show this study. This is taken from this paper by Lewis et al. This is this astro page, this number. So this is a study of the number. So this is a study of the prize fellowship recipients. So in astrophysics, we have this very, in the US, this is a study that was done in the US, these very prestigious national fellowships, Hubble Fellowship, Switzer Fellowship, Chandra Fellowship, all the Sagan Fellowship, the top fellowships, postdoctoral fellowship. And they were trying to see that suppose if this in the graduate admission, there was a strict cutoff of the physics GRE examination, which is similar to the JAM, JEST, TIFR entrance or presidency entrance examination. You see, if the cutoff was less than 10%, then, and this is the number of, so the sample size is 149. So you can see that suppose the cutoff was less than 40%, we would miss 13 of the male prize fellows getting entrance into the PhD program, 14 of the women fellows. These are top fellows. They have done very well in graduate school. That's why they got the top fellowships. And if you increase the cutoff, look, 60%, 33.3% of the male prize fellowship recipient would be out of graduate school. They would have never studied astrophysics or physics. And 60% of these top scientists, top women scientists, would be out of graduate school. You increase the number, it is getting worse and worse. The major point of this table is that you can become a very fantastic scientist, get prize fellowships, and I'll show you the first author papers that these fellows wrote, and they have very less correlation with the entrance test with which they are being admitted into the program. Now, in the US, it's not just the subject GRE. There are multiple things. Thank God, that's why these talented people could get into the graduate program. Here, we just have multiple test question. And what you can see, just look at this number. 60.4% women are out. 33, so it's double compared to the male applicants. If you have a 90% cutoff, 92.5% of the prize fellows, women prize fellows, could have never made it to graduate school. It's less. So you can see that performance in multiple choice based tests is significantly, this is the disturbing correlation, that there is a disturbing correlation. It has been shown that women, minorities, and people from socioeconomically a disadvantaged background have chances to perform less in the standardized test, and these standardized tests turn out to be useless when you count the metric of success. So we are using a useless admission criteria to take people into our program, which have no correlation of how fantastic they will be as scientists. And we are significantly, biasedly, in a biased way, eliminating all these talented people. Okay, I mean, they would have been the case. Yes, I'll just. This is the number of first author papers. Sorry, what happened? Yeah, this is the number of first author papers. This is almost my last slide. And you can see the number of first author papers. So they're very successful scientists, and they have been eliminated if we had this. So the question was that this is a biased admission criteria. This study came out, and then it created a sensation. The then AAS president, Meguiri, wrote an open letter from the American Astronomical Society, and many departments all over the US, particularly astronomy departments, took proactive measures. They made a rule that we don't want PGRE in our, so we will focus on, there were suggestions that what other things which are more better metric to measure success should be get, and that is more inclusive, and that has less correlation with gender and all that. So Professor Nisim Kanekar from NCRA, he actually has the statistics for JEST, TIFR entrance and all that. Unfortunately, Nisim was going to give me that statistics, but there were some issues and we couldn't be in touch. So next time I'll be happy to share the statistics that he did for Indian admission examinations, PhD admission examination. And I'd like to end this talk with this very, very talented student of ours. She told me we can use her name. Her name is Konaya Malakar. She was an SN Bhatt fellow at ICTS, very, very talented. She played immense leadership role in the department. And recently, her paper with folks at ICTS, her first author paper, got accepted as a master's student. She wrote a first author paper collaborating with scientists spanning three continents. And this is in Journal of Statistical Physics. And she was awarded the SN Bhatt Fellowship, did fantastic work. People at ICTS talk about her. And Kona, for example, is not good at taking this kind of tests, and she didn't manage to, you know, do very well in this admission test. Now, this is just one example. I have many examples in my department where there are very talented individuals, they are fantastic, have potential as scientists, but we are systematically making them go out of the field. So I would just urge very smart and thoughtful people in the audience to give it a thought. Thank you very much.
Any questions? Yeah.
City, you clubbed UG and PG.
Yes.
If you have broken them, will this percentage be very different?
So, no, it's exact, almost same.
Because I remember when I was in Presidency College, out of 30, we were only 4 girls, and we used to sit in one part of the bench and others.
Well, now they don't sit in one part of the bench because now girls and boys, but it's still, the picture is still the same. So in my batch, there were 9 out of, our batch was fantastic. We had 9 out of 29 students as women, but it's 1, 2, 3, 4, and terrible. Very sad. And when you teach a class like that, it's just extremely sad. Yeah.
I, from my experience, it has been not so much the actual standardized test, but the interview component that comes after the standardized test, in which the women show a lot of lack of self-esteem.
Yes.
And I think that lack of self-esteem has a crucial factor to play both in being a scientist and being admitted to a prestigious institution. And I find that in India at least, women do well on the
tests. You are lucky, but the thing is that even, you know, in this test, they don't make it and they think that, oh, I am not so good. That is the lack of self-esteem, that there is some standardized test, they don't do well. And they think that, oh, I can never be a scientist. This is the problem that I'm facing. And their male counterparts, not being even as smart as them, they are doing well. It's just a question of confidence and stuff.
Did you have a question at the back? You did? I thought you raised your hand. Okay.
I think there is a...
I have a slightly long one. Yeah. So one thing which I wanted to say was that, by and large, this is something which most of us have always felt, that we have felt it started, I think every generation of women who has been in science has felt this, that we have felt the discrimination. Okay, but I think the point at which things started changing was when we stopped talking from our personal experience and anecdotes, and we got down to hard data. It's when we started talking in terms of hard data, in terms of hard numbers, that in fact the rest of the scientific community started taking our complaints more seriously. Okay, I think so. What, as groups which work on women in science or physics are concerned, is that we really have to put more effort into putting more hard data into the kind of reports, etc., that we make. Some sources can be pointed out. DST has a lot of data. Okay? It's not broken up into individual sciences always. Okay, so that is the problem. I just want to point you people at the sources. Okay, but even the data at the science level, at the science, arts, commerce level is pretty telling. Okay, so that's also useful. The other thing which I wanted to say, if you want JEE data, all IITs collect JEE data, and JEE is a huge example. There is this perception that there are no women in IIT. It is not true, because IIT is not, because people mostly think of undergraduates, they don't think of postgraduates. And we have a huge number of postgraduate girls, as people like Prajval and I having been PGs in IIT.
I was in IIT Kanpur, and we had only two girls in a class of, it was the MSc class. Yeah.
So there is a study on the IIT question, there's a study, the JEE is still very, very gendered. And it is shown, there's a study which shows that there is no correlation between JEE performance and internalized IIT performance. Internal IIT performance is not gendered. Pre-IIT JEE performance is not gendered, but the JEE is gendered. So,
What I wanted to say was that IITs collect data for every year, for every this thing, for every exam, for just for JAM, the data is available. So that's something which can be useful.
Okay. So
thirdly, from last year, at least I know this for IIT because I work in IIT. There is in fact, they now have a special quota for women.
Supernumerary.
They have supernumerary positions for women. EST has schemes for women. So all these should be included in the kind of reports that we
So there's a question from the chat which says that what about, doesn't this affect men as well, the idea of the standardized tests?
So, yeah, so I think the study that shows that it affects men who belong to more like minority communities. I mean, men who are already underrepresented in physics, men who are belong to communities which are, you know, majority, who are well represented in physics, they get advantage. They just get advantage. Doesn't mean that they are better scientists.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Sujetna.
Thank you very much.
So let's move on to the next talk. Sorry?
Yes, there's a comment.
That data, I can share that there is a DST brought out a very big report. And if you don't, this is just something we should also know, is that if we don't restrict only to the ICERS, NICERS, IITs and TIFRs, the fraction of students, women students in physics in India is actually quite high. It's about 25%. It's very healthy, and it is something quite unusual compared to the European American studies that we are mentioning. So there is something very different in India, and we need to understand that and not follow the processes they set in place, because the point that you are making is of apex, as a very small fraction, concerns, as she said, concerns very small number of people. The solutions we want to look at is not changing the way people are admitted, but solution is once you are admitted, actually I think in India more important is when you are in school, when you are in doing PhD or when you are a faculty, how things, that is the thing where we need to address, and not at the entrance. I tend to disagree with you on this.
I think what I want to say is that why do we, even at these top institutions, why do we have less representation?
All I'm trying to say is that you are saying that there's no statistics.
Here is a very small part, and what we need to address is somewhere else, not really at the entrance right now.
This is a very complex issue. I'm just trying to highlight that this issue
maybe it's not important in India, I don't know, but I just like to make it a point that do you think that it's not at all worth.
Yeah. I think we need to go to the next question. Yeah, Shobhana.
I think there are many facets of this problem, and we have to tackle all of them. Obviously, we do have different patterns of people dropping out at different stages in India than they do abroad. I agree with your point, Rohini. But it is also a matter of concern if our elite institutions have a very small percentage of women in physics. This is also something to notice and to address.
Yeah. Okay, we need to move on to the next talk. Thanks, Sujetana. So we'll have Suratna Das, who is an Inspire faculty from IIT Kanpur, a cosmologist. She was part of the India team to the EQIP last year. Suratna.
Hi, so I was the youngest member who joined this ICWIP 2017. And I don't have any data to show, but I will just like to point out why I attended this meeting and what made me think that there is a gender gap in physics and that is a serious problem which one should address. And it is high time when one should address. So to start with, as a PhD student or as a BSc, MSc student, as a PhD student, I never thought of this problem very seriously. I'll come to that point later. But when I was at TIFA, I met this lady, this very famous lady, Jocelyn Bell. She was visiting TIFA, and everybody obviously would be knowing her story that she was denied. She was not considered for the Nobel Prize for discovering pulsars. And she was visiting TIFA, and she made me think consciously about the gender issues in practicing science. I mean, she gave a very inspiring talk. Her life itself is a very inspiring story. And then she asked very, very, very simple questions. That one of such questions was, have you ever looked at a form, any general form which one fills up? So you have to take your gender, male and female, but why female comes after male? Does it at all, is it alphabetical? Or, I mean, very simple things will make you understand that you are living in a society which is somehow biased. In some way, it is biased. So, okay, so she was there for almost a week, and we had discussed a lot. And I was really started thinking that maybe there is an issue which one should really look at. And then in 2015, this thing came. I mean, it was a real, real shocker for everybody. It was a real shocker. I mean, when I read this thing, I mean, I just want to read it again. So this guy is this person is a Nobel laureate from 2001. His name is Sir Richard Timothy Hunt. And he was asked to address a conference on journalism of journalists. And he said, so let me tell you, I mean, he was addressing a conference. And he said that, let me tell you about my trouble with girls. Three things happen when they are in a lab. You fall in love with them, they fall in love with you. And when you criticize them, they cry. Perhaps we should make separate labs for boys and girls. I mean, it was shocking, but then I started thinking, I mean, is it a personal view of this person or is it something people are really thinking about girls? I mean, this was really, really pathetic. And then I started really looking around what's happened. I mean, how women are being treated in a science society. And then I'll just point out a few of the incidents which happened around me. I'll not name anybody, but that really made me think how women are being treated in a scientific society. So let's start with the incident. So I'll start with the topmost from the faculties, and then I'll go down in the hierarchy. So. Person one, she was a faculty and she was expecting actually and had a medical complications and doctor had advised her to rest. Then she goes to the HOD. She said that it was in the middle of a semester. She said that I'm expecting and there's some medical complications. I will certainly finish this same course, but which was still a couple of months left from that time. So she was saying that I will come and finish this semester, but I fear that I won't be able to take any course next semester. And I have to take, anyway, I have to take a medical leave. The person too is a male, of course, HOD. Of course, there was no female HOD ever in the history of IIT Kanpur. So without sparing any word of congratulations or any words on concerning her, regarding her health, he said that, then who will take the course on behalf of you? Bluntly. Okay? So person one, she actually went around requesting her colleagues to replace her next semester. So HOD did nothing. She had to come up with an alternative. Okay, so that was, I don't know, how should I call it? Incident two. So it happened when I was there in front of me actually. So there was a female postdoc. She was a faculty member's wife. So she was also expecting and the terms end just before her delivery. So the postdoctoral term ends just before her delivery. So she was admitted to the hospital for a delivery. And when she was there in the hospital, a mail was sent to her to vacate her office as soon as possible. The moment she came back from the hospital, the very next day, she was there in the office. She was vacating her office. She took two full days to vacate her office. And the office remained vacant for next 3 months. So the department was on no need of that office for next 3 months.
But she was sent a mail that she had to vacate the office in no time. And she did it. Okay? So the bottom line, I mean, there are many stories, but the bottom line is the system is really insensitive towards very natural needs of a woman. So IITK, which was founded 58 years ago, felt the need of having a creche only a couple of years back. And now a creche is running successfully for past 1 year and so. And now people, I mean, women in the campus, they are thinking of doing something fruitful, okay, because of this creche. But this happened 58 years after that. Okay, now I'm going down in hierarchy. So let me talk about what one incident. So there was one faculty member, which was male, who was thinking of taking a PhD student that year. He said that this time too many female candidates have been selected for PhD. I wanted a PhD student this time. But so there was another person who he was talking to. He was also male. He was also a faculty member. He said, see, I have two male and two female students as PhD students. And my experiences with them show that female students are much more sincere and knowledgeable. And the person once said, who I know that he is actually a socialist, says, yes, but until they get married. And then he stopped. And because I was sitting there and I was looking at him, okay, come on, what do you want to say? So he just stopped. And the same mindset is there. I was told by a male faculty member that I really do not like to have female PhD students because at first you put a lot of effort to make them and then they get married and that's the end of the story. Not only male. I was discussing this with a female faculty member and she also said, I too believe that female PhD students are not serious enough towards their job. They give priorities to other things. I think family, she was probably looking for the word. A female PhD student should not get married until they get settled. I guess permanent position. Only then they can take science seriously. Bottom line, the system is consciously or unconsciously biased, which is harmful for a female student trying to pursue higher education in science. This is a general mindset, very general mindset. But when I was making this slide, I was thinking why I was not made conscious about this kind of gender biases, because I think so far I have collaborated with 19 persons, only one of them is a female. But I never failed this because I think I have always dealt with very nice gentlemen. I should name a few of them, Subhendro and TP, Raghu, Kinjal, Satyabrata, my own husband with whom I have worked. I mean, they are really gentlemen and they never made me feel that I am a woman and I should not be doing a male's job. But anyway, but the general picture is not that good. I might be fortunate, okay? But then, so now let's talk about job seekers. So mostly, it is a very common question being asked at IIT Kanpur. Female faculty members always being asked if a job is being offered to them, whether she would like to be able to leave her husband who is working somewhere else and join the faculty member at IIT Kanpur. Such questions are never being asked to any male faculty candidate. No one had ever faced these kind of questions. And one isolated incident, which was very funny, a female candidate was being asked whether she was married or not. And when she replied that she is not married, then the faculty member was shocked. Strange, why you're not married? Anyway, I mean, women are supposed to be get married at some age, okay? She's an applicant and she's not married, and it was very shocking. But as because I'm seeking jobs, I also feel I should share my experience. I was told that spouses should not apply in the same department where her husband is already in service. I mean, I think this is a very common stereotype in the thing. And again, I have been told several times not to write papers with my husband because we work in the same area. But I feel it's so disgusting that I sometimes really feel like asking them, what do they think about Madame Curie and Irene Curie? I mean, do they really think that Madame Curie and Irene Curie did nothing? And why it is my, why if I write a paper, if I write a paper with my husband, should reflect my inability to write papers? Why it not should reflect my husband's inability to write a paper? Right? It is true that he is teaching, he is doing all the administrative job, and I am writing a paper for him. That's more logical than thinking that he's writing a paper for me. Come on. So it is disgusting. I really feel disgusted when someone says this thing to me. Okay. So bottom line is female faculty candidates are being judged. Oh yeah, I'm incorrect. Being judged differently than male faculty candidates, which are not based on academic merits. So is it unconscious bias? I don't think so, but maybe stereotypes. So one of the stereotypes which is there in the academia is that a person, if he has no foreign experiences, does not understand any science. So this is a common understanding. So ICWIP, I really enjoyed because I had seen participants from 40 plus countries who had joined there. So it shows us the vastness, how gender issue in physics is, it's actually a global phenomenon. So many talks were inspiring. Malala Yousafzai was also, of course, icing on the top. But then, which I really enjoyed is the unconscious bias workshop. So it really made me understand what kind of unconscious biases are there in the society. So this is how unconscious bias can be understood, that unconscious bias refers to bias that we are unaware of and which happens outside of our control. It is a bias that happens automatically and is triggered by our brain making quick judgments and assessments of people and situations influenced by our background, cultural environment, and personal experiences. So if you just, there was one lady who was trying this puzzle to everybody. So let's say there are two persons, a doctor and a nurse, who survived a shipwreck and started living in an isolated island. So they had a child after a few years, but the doctor was not the father of the child and the nurse was not the mother of the child either. So how? So I have seen people fumbled. How it could happen? The simple answer is doctor and nurse are two gender neutral words. Come on, doctor doesn't mean that he has to be a male and nurse doesn't mean that she has to be a female. It can be the other way around. But I have really seen people fumble. Oh, really, how it can happen? Maybe there's something very tricky going on. So simple. But this is unconscious bias. If I say doctor, I mean a male person, but it's not true. Stereotypes, okay, a set of beliefs about personal attributes of group of people. Just I've said that female students are not serious about their careers, foreign experience. I had given such examples. And what I see, WP had given me a gift to meet my role model again. So she was given the President's Medal in that workshop, so I could meet Jocelyn again. I talked to her, so it was a nice experience. And of course, I thank Shubhavati, Prajwal, and Reshmi for giving me the opportunity to be a part of ICTW 2017, and thanks Prajwal for inviting me to share my thoughts.
We have time for a couple of very, very quick questions. Yeah, Shubhavati.
I want to make a comment,
yes,
which is that when I was applying for job, maybe it was 2000, 2002, and at that time it was the kind of similar, like one place said that we cannot give you a job because your husband is here. Another place said that we cannot give her a job because will she come because her husband is there.
That's a conundrum. That's a
by
conundrum.
Having a husband, you cannot, you are disqualified in two places, in many places. And I'm sorry that, you know, this situation has not yet changed.
Yes.
It's so many years.
I want to first compliment you on a very nice presentation.
Oh, thank you.
But I just thought that I will tell you that you are being told not to write papers with your husband.
Yes.
But many, many years back in Europe, so this is not even in India, when I was introduced to one physicist, he said, yes, I have seen papers by your husband.
Oh, one of my senior came to IIT Kanpur for a job talk. And he said, okay, so he had some 6-7 papers. And he asked me, how many papers you have? I said, I have 16. The next question he asked me, how many of them have been written by your husband? I was like, please, come on. I couldn't even reply to that question.
Yeah, we need to move on very quickly, Bindu.
Why don't you say? I just thought I'd give you one more anecdote. At one interview, I was asked that how much of this with a paper with my husband, how much of this paper did you contribute to? So I replied, well, we have a son, which is a joint collaboration. You tell me how much I have contributed to.
Nice.
Okay. I have a couple of things to comment. So nice presentation, but when you gave the example of Marie Curie, I hope you know the story that Marie Curie's name was not nominated first. And
I have recently written an article on her, so exactly. I know that story. Huh. Yeah, he opposed
it. Yeah. But other thing was that it was mentioned that Marie Curie was assistant to Professor Marie Curie.
Yeah, I know. That in the University of Sorbonne.
Okay, so that is one thing. But then second, of course, she got, when he was not alive, that is another thing. We should not comment on that. But when you say that when the papers are written by both husband and wife, there are sometimes problems, because I also was sitting in one women's scientist committee, and we had one case where there were something like 10 papers before her PhD and with her husband. And then it was very surprising for us how she could write so many papers. Okay, so there arise sometimes some problems. Okay, then another
I agree,
thing
but I one should see the other papers written by that girl.
That is true.
Lady, right?
Okay, okay. Yeah, okay. Okay, you want to stop me?
Raise your comment.
Okay, so let's move on now, and we have Professor Shubhapati Goswami from the Physical Research Laboratory. She's a member of the Gender and Physics Working Group, and she was also the team member last year at the EQIP.
Hello. I would like to thank ICTS and Prajval for arranging this. I was asked to talk about gender disparity and sexual harassment. And I will start with some data. Like, you know, this is the gender inequality index, which was published in around 2014, and which is like 127 out of 152, which is UNDP's index. Another was World Economics Forum Global Gender Gap Index. And you can see that in India is 114 in the list of 142, and educational achievement, it's 126. Of course, it's doing very well in political empowerment among women. However, in education, it's 126. So India is that data, which is showing that India is not really doing that good in the in gender. Now, what is gender discrimination? Of course, we all know, we have felt it. It is unequal treatment or perceptions of individuals based on gender. It's a very subtle and complex issue. And it stems from unequal power relations, which is widespread in the society. And the central thing is androcentrism, which was, you know, proposed in 1911. And it is like the male thinking is the worldview. Like, that's normal. And female thinking is a deviant or inferior, of course, when it is different. And this generates from a perceived notion about what women are fit for, and which we are like called gender stereotyping. There are other kind of stereotyping also, but here we are talking about from the perspective of women. And I would like to say that, you know, this is different from sexual harassment. It is not the same. But extreme sexism may foster harassment. So that is something also which we have to think. Now, we have to come to academia. It has gender bias. And we know that, you know, certain subjects are considered as female subjects and certain subjects are considered as male subjects. So this problem not only women face. Supposing some boy wants to take English, then, you know, there will be a opposition from the family or the teachers. And it's, you know, it exists at the school level. Like, I remember that I went for a meeting, teacher-student meeting in my daughter's school, and the headmistress is saying, someone said that, are you going to start arts? Because Ahmedabad, somehow we don't have so many arts. I'm from Ahmedabad. Arts stream in class 11 and 12. And then the principal says that, yes, especially for girls. This is the school principal who is saying this. And you know, that class, my daughter's class, that was a very good class. And there were so many girls who were doing very well, and they were doing the better results. They were at the top. So I wanted to protest, but my daughter held my hand, because, you know, you can't protest against principals for them. So it's like that. So it starts from that level. And this is what Reshmi already showed, that this is the percentage of women in research institute we have seen, and in leadership roles, 3%, abysmally low. And this is, I don't know, like this data, what we presented in this paper, ICWIP paper, was that if we include all the universities and institutes, then it was about 45%. If we don't include the universities, then it's little less than this. So what is the reason for this drop? There is a mid-career drop of women. There are family issues. There are two-body problems. But the question that we should ask is that the only reason? And what I observed is that this is the global trend, but such a sharp dropout was not reported. Okay. And another thing is that, which was asked, Reshmi also said, that whether there is a proactive initiative to increase the number of women faculty. There are institutes in India which have no women faculty, and it's in a field where there are many, many women researchers. So whether they are taking it, it's all there. The statistics is there institute-wise in our paper. So it's that question. And also, are we taking any measures to decrease the gender gap in leadership? So, you know, the kind of gender discrimination that we face, Suchetana has said about many things. So my experimental colleagues, I come from a place where there are many experimental fields also. They say that they are deemed unsuitable for experimental work with heavy instruments. So one of my colleagues who is doing very well there, she operates on an instrument called nanosims. And, you know, she was discouraged from joining the experimental division. Then also works that entail long hours and field trips. Then also, like if you are a woman supervisor, then there is a perception that you are less strict. So supposing in a batch, there are three students who have delayed their submission or four students, then the student who is with the woman supervisor, they will say, oh, you are not strict with them. So these are the kind of things, you know, which we have to face. Then another thing is that women are put in soft committees. Like, you know, not in important decision-making committees, like, I don't know, like purchase committee or even academic committee. Like, you know, I was always put in medical committee or advise on the library committee, like those committees. I have, I would say, in PRL, maximum number of students and postdocs. So I was never put in those academic committees, let alone purchase and, you know, other important money matters, forget about them. So then, you know, I had to fight for it. I went and told that what's going on. And then now I am a member of the PDF committee, and I would like to mention in question of what Shuratna mentioned that, you know, we had a case where a girl is pregnant and she wanted some extra time and all, and I think I negotiated it well and I understood her problem. So this is what happens that, you know, when you have the perspective from the other gender also, I am not saying that, you know, it should be 50-50. So that perspective should come in any decision-making process, which we are missing. So of course, chairperson of the committees, there also you have to fight. You have to let your, you know, voice, you have to raise your voice. You can't stay silent. That's what I would like to say. And all these arise from a notion of male supremacy. It can be conscious or it can be unconscious. So what I feel is that gender sensitization and gender policy, that should be must in all academic institutes. We should have a, you know, well-documented gender policy. That I think we don't have and we should have. Now I would give some highlights from the ICWIP conference, which I got a chance to attend from this perspective. And it focused on all these issues, stereotypes, conscious and unconscious bias, mid-career dropouts, inequality in pay and delayed progression in the professional career of women physicists. Also, some success stories and good practices were shared. One quote by Jocelyn Bell Barnell, which really resonated with me, were that rules have been made keeping men in mind and women are asked to adapt to it. But system should adapt to women. Many times, you know, we hear this, oh, women are emotional, or, oh, please behave like a man. A man is also told this. So these are the kind of things, you know, like we have the stereotype in mind. But for case of women, like all the timings, if you see, everything that, you know, we are going with, that is kept. That time, not so many women were there. So that's what was our central point. And I know that, you know, many, I have gone to women's conferences where sometimes even women say, oh, you know, you should not be so emotional. Why don't you go for a couple of drinks with men in the evening? You know, it's up to me. I think it's a personal choice whether I would like to go for a couple of drinks with men or not. It's a personal choice. And the office rules should adapt to women, like, you know, in terms of flexible timing and, you know, like leave policies, etc. We have certain things like the maternity leave or the, you know, child care leave. But there also it's the, you know, people who don't have a permanent job or something. They have problems there, even in academic institutes. Now, this Reshmi already mentioned, so I don't need to mention, but this is the things which UK is doing, which I really liked, this Project Juno and the Athena's One Charter. And Australia has implemented this through this science in Australian Gender Equity, SAGE. And the procedures are this: institutes collect and analyze their data on gender equity, scrutinize their policies and processes to identify gaps and opportunities, develop action plan to improve gender equity and diversity at all levels of seniority. Now the question is, can we initiate similar programs in India? We already have a lot of initiatives taken, like, you know, we have these women scientist fellowships and we have these mobility schemes, we have child care leaves, but perhaps we can have a more collective approach under a pilot project and to see where there are gaps and where we can still improve. So then I come to the next part, sexual harassment. And, you know, I don't need to read these things. These are all known to everyone. But the main important thing here is that, you know, which is also written in the handbook, that impact, not intent, is what matters. So how a woman perceives it, what you call harassment, is also how a woman perceives it. And when I was discussing this with some of my younger colleagues, they said, madam, this emotional safety is very important. So that is also there. You know, if there is a touch or something, then that stays with you in your whole life. So that emotional well-being is very important. So I will not come to all this because there is another talk on ICC. So there are some existing laws, but what I would like to report is that, you know, 70% of the cases are unreported and 47% of women feel ICC members lack knowledge of legal provisions. We are going to hear more from Tanushree what are their problems. This was a survey conducted by the Bar Association. And what is the scenario in academia? Unfortunately, we don't have really any statistics. This is a very small sample which was collected by UGC. It showed maximum number of cases from UP, which is in the campus. However, there is from academic institutes and universities, I did not find any such data, but reports indicate number of cases are on the rise. And you know, this is a sample statistics from a US, from Northwestern University. You know, they have a, you know, they show that, you know, how many complaints, you know, what are their resolution, how many were resolved, how many were not resolved, etc. And we need this kind of statistics. And then there were all these social media movements and there were a lot of debates about this. But my point here is that identity of sexual harasser is not always a secret. Women's Whisper campaign exists among women's network and we need to focus on the real issue, which is that this problem is widespread. And the problem is that there are also subtle and implicit forms and which can easily pass off as inequal statements, comment or action, or sometimes people are not sure. So how can we deal with this? And then the one part is that 70% of the cases are unreported. So what are the reasons? So there are psychological trauma, victim blaming, not being sure if it is actually an harassment. And you know, there are so many reasons. There are, you know, fear of getting involved in a long, long process. There is also this kind of apprehensions for the repercussion of the family of the colleague. Women think in terms of that, especially if it is a known person. So the thing is, what can we do to encourage reporting, the availability of counseling? Because sometimes when this kind of incident happens, you think a lot of things, you don't want to face it. You think maybe whether you are responsible in any way or not, especially it happens when you know a person. So the thing is that, you know, the process have to be streamlined and made accessible and not off-putting. And the problem is this, that there is a problem which is that complaint committees, unless they have very strong members, tend to soft-pedal incidents in technological institutes with the reputation. This was by a professor from IIT, so she mentioned technological institutes, may be true for others also. Reputation of the institutes and without, so that it doesn't gain much publicity.
It is also tougher to deal with cases involving faculty, as it can affect their employment and take the cases to court. More from on this from Tanushree. So my take on this is that, you know, prevention is the key. We have to have regular meetings, orientation programs, sensitization workshops, and during induction of the students, because they are most vulnerable, we should give this information. We should supply a handbook to all employees and put the information on the websites, and there should be a sexual harassment as well as a gender policy. So what I say is that we need a more organized and transparent approach. We need the statistics on how many cases have been reported to ICC, how many could be resolved, how many went in the favor of the complainant, how many cases got acquitted in court even if held guilty by ICC. When we have all these data, you know, then we would be able to know what is the real situation. So I feel there should be a national effort to collect the statistics and review the situation, including the role of ICC. So we should see whether it's the problem with the Act, ICC, or the implementation, and we can make recommendations on the basis of that. So that's what I would like to say. And, you know, I want to finish with something which is very unrelated, which somehow I saw today. This is the person, she has built her hospital. She was a daily laborer, and she is receiving the Padma Shri. So why I wanted to show this was, you know, we must acknowledge women power.
Thanks. Just a couple of very, very quick questions or comments. Okay.
Just really very quick. Thanks. I think it was a very nice presentation. I wanted to tell you that personally, I and a few other people have been involved in trying to see whether one can set up a project on the lines of Sage or Athena Swan for a few years. We have not yet been successful, but maybe
that will
get
be
more
good
traction. Maybe we can think more specifically.
Yeah, let me know, Rohini, if I can help.
So, can I? So, yeah. So, no, I just had a comment that you mentioned that women are kept in soft committees. Now, this has kind of become fashionable, that many institutes project that they just keep them in useless committees where there are not many decision taking, and project it as a case that, oh, look, we are so proactive in giving women leadership role and everything. So I'm just curious that what the community thinks about it. It is just proactively done to propagate that, yes, we are, this is a propaganda, we are doing well for women, but actually we are not giving them anything.
Unconscious bias also.
I think it's conscious, yeah.
Yeah, I suggest we take this up in the larger discussion later because we are running short of time. Yeah.
I just, you know, as a counseling psychologist, I just wanted to respond to the notion of soft committees and hard committees. And actually, one of the things that perhaps is useful in order to address issues is when so-called soft committees actually are doing far more work to address issues like this, right? So that's one of the things where, for instance, you know, sexual harassment committees or other committees like that that might seem, which might seem to be, so I don't know if that's what you mean when you say soft.
No, you know, I want to make one comment. Like, you know, I was put in library committee, and for once we had to take a decision about buying some new furnitures from library. So we did all the study, etc., and we have sent that report. Then another committee was formed with a male member as the chairperson to oversee that. And they went along with that, but, you know, they could not buy those things on the recommendation of two women heading that committee, me and the librarian. So these are the things which I meant. Sexual harassment committee, of course, women are there. They are taking the major role. More than 50% should be women.
Okay, let's, thanks, Shubhavati. And let's move on to Professor Tanushree Sahadas Gupta from the Indian Association for the Cultivation of Sciences. She is a member of the Gender and Physics Working Group.
Can you, sir? Yeah. Thanks, Prajval. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Thanks, Prajval, for this really nice meeting and getting all of us here so that we can share our views. So I will not be using any slides. I will just use my words to convey my message. I think Subhavati set the stage very nicely for me to take over. I just wanted to share my experience as an ICC member in my former institute, because I thought my experience personally raised some questions, and somehow it should be put in some forum so that people can think about it, debate about it, and try to resolve it in certain way. So I have been the ICC member in my former institute, and it had a tenure of 3 years. And in my tenure, there were 2 cases. And I must say, in both the cases, I really had unsatisfactory experience. The second case being more severe than the former one. In the first case, it was between a supervisor and a PhD student, and a complaint was made, and we went through the complaint. The girl didn't want to really carry it forward because, according to her, she could not take the mental stress that is associated with it. Although we had really concrete evidence that there was a firm basis of her complaint. So since she didn't want to proceed, we decided to stop the matter there. But we had a recommendation which was sent to the director then, saying that this person, who is also involved in the administration and rather high up in the position of the administration, should not continue in that position, because since the complaint was made, he can actually cause harm to many of the people who are involved in the process. To our biggest surprise, this recommendation was never honored. In the second case, the girl were more courageous and wanted to have a fight. So since she wanted to have a fight and the justice, we had to go through a really, really elaborate process of making the witness, taking their record, and hours long. It even happened that our committee meeting went until 10 o'clock in the night, and we had to be all there. And we kind of arrived to a decision based on the recording that apparently we found that the allegation had some basis. But at that point, the tenure of our committee was ending. And we were really didn't know what to do since our tenure was ending. Recording has been made, but no transcript has been made. So what should we do? So according to the authority, they consulted some legal firm, and the answer of the legal firm is we should not continue. I really don't know if a case is ongoing, can a committee be asked to step down? I really don't know. And so far, I don't have the answer in writing. I have asked for several times that this legal opinion can I really see in writing, and this has not been given to us. So being feeling very helpless and undecided what to do, we put up a form of a preliminary report, all our findings. And our job ended there because the committee was dismantled after that. Very good. Then the new committee took over. And after a lot of discussion between the director, governing body, and everything, they decided to serve this preliminary report to both the parties. And based on that, the accused went to the court and put a court case against all the members of the ICC by name. Now, the point is, I really don't know what is the legal opinion. We actually had a legal person in the committee. Is that I had the idea that ICC has almost the status of a civil court. So if something is going on in ICC, does it allow a person to go to a higher court? I really don't know. I got a mixed answer. I have actually consulted many of the lawyers. And law is very complex. And I am not a lawyer. I tried to go through the details of the act. It's kind of contradictory. Anyhow, now the message is, if by putting a complaint, when the ICC proceeding is not even complete, if the person really has a right to go to the court and put some kind of a stay order on the proceeding of ICC, then how do you deal with it? The funniest thing came even after that. Apparently, a lawyer was appointed who will actually fight for us. But this lawyer never consulted, never ever consulted us. And in the court, he admitted that there were some flaws in our proceeding. Without even consulting, how can he even make that statement? It's not clear. So I find this whole thing really, really kind of very disappointing. And it leads us to a situation where we should ask the question, what is really the role of ICC? Is it just a decorative body? If it is so, better we do away with it. Because we have spent a lot of time and think about this poor student who took the courage of putting a complaint, fighting, having mental trauma, having lost all the years she had with the previous supervisor, changing the supervisor, changing the field, passing through mental trauma. Why should we do this? In fact, one of the questions Subhabati had is, many of the cases, they go unreported. It will be. Who will like to take this risk of going through such a nightmare experience? I just want to put this question in front of the committee. There are many learned members, so that we should really try avoiding such situation. Thank you very much.
Questions? Yeah, please. Do you have a mic?
So actually it's a personal experience, the sexual harassment I faced before joining this institute. So I was teaching at NIT Jamshedpur just after I submitted my thesis and before I joined here as a postdoc for some 8 months. So there was a fellow professor so who did some indecent actions with me. I reported it to the ICC committee, and it was a rigorous process. It went on for many months, but thankfully I was very lucky that all the other male members supported me, many of them, and it was reported that it has been proved and he should be demoted, and a personal letter of apology and all the ICC gave all this recommendation to the Board of Governors committee, but till now they have not done anything. So I don't know now what to do. So actually I wrote to Prime Minister's complaints office. There is a portal there also. So, and this time also I was lucky, they were very swift in action. So the IAS officer who was appointed this case, he actually asked NIT Jamshedpur, what have you done? They told that in next BOG committee meeting, we are will be doing it. But they have kept on delaying it, and now I don't know what to do, actually. So.
It's a very similar experience with many of us, and for some, I don't really understand the institute's standpoint. They always like to protect, and that to me sounds very, very funny. If I were really in the administration, I would have really taken a step to give a message that we can create a harassment-free environment, but somehow they think differently.
I'll tell you what to do. These institutes are very, very wary of RTIs. File an RTI, it costs 10 rupees or something really ridiculous. And you file an RTI, they will get onto it immediately. File an RTI.
Okay, Bish, you have a question? Okay.
Yeah. Actually, to file an RTI, ma'am, what you were saying that she or anyone, XYZ, should file an RTI. But if the case, madam has told that the accused has gone to court or somewhere else, then what will do? What will the victim or the complainant should do? Then also can she file an RTI against the institute that why you have not punished the perpetrator?
Yes.
Still
yes.
She can file.
Yes.
even if the matter is dealing with the court.
Yes, I'm not too sure about that because I'm not a legal person. I'm not too sure, but I do know that in our institute, in our university, I'm a member of GS Cash, I was. And when such cases happened, when the institute didn't act, we had to respond to the RTIs.
Because all time, we have come to know that if the matter is with court, means whenever we have asked any questions to any member of ICC or anywhere of the institute, register or director or anywhere, they continuously tell us that, no, the matter is sub judice, so we cannot tell anything. No,
but
the matter is.
But if CP Grams, she filed her complaint to the Prime Minister's office, could ask the question and they got an answer, that means obviously for her the matter is not in court.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, there's one very quick clarification from Shubhashree Deshikan.
I think the 2013 Act, it specifically says that the proceedings of the ICC are not. You need not open it out to RTI. There is some clause like that. I just wanted to. I think it's
yeah, the
protected.
Action taken is amenable to RTI, not
right.
The proceedings.
The action taken is
proceedings comes under privacy. Yeah. So thank you very much, and let's move on. We'll have Professor Anita Kurup, who I mentioned in my talk. She's a sociologist from NIAS. She led this academy study in collaboration with Professor Rohini Godbole a few years ago on the gender gap in science.
Good afternoon, and thank you for this opportunity, Prajval. I just want to sort of share with you the kind of questions we engage with in terms of research on questions of women in the STEM. My interest in this area has been over a decade, and we have looked at several ways in which these questions could be addressed. And what I would want to share with you all broadly is, if I look at the kind of work that we have been doing over this decade, I would broadly sort of state what are the guiding questions or research questions that we are looking with respect to women in the STEM discipline. I have not specifically looked at women in physics, although right now we are trying to see if we can get discipline-specific data and see if there is a pattern, a variation, or is there some way in which we can understand it better? The larger question that guides the studies that we are doing is to evaluate women's professional success when compared to men. So we are looking at professional success, and here we look at numbers, we look at educational level, we look at representations, we also ask questions of stereotypes. These are the broad areas around which the research questions are constructed. We also look at questions of professional outcomes vis-a-vis familial outcomes, because we feel that professional outcomes and familial outcomes are not decoupled and they do coexist. So similarly, when we are talking of professional outcomes and familial outcomes, we also are looking at workspaces along with spaces within family, because these are again spaces in which women and men coexist. More importantly, I think what we are trying to also see over the years is to try and see whether we could construct the questions with respect to women and science rather than women in science by treating one as a larger category and looking at the questions of women within that larger category. Can we look at these as two independent categories that are actually interfacing? And is that framework, is it better for us to understand the questions if we use a framework of that kind? The other guiding questions we are looking at is, can we look at the pipeline metaphor? Trace the journey of women scientists from the level of school undergraduates up to the level of faculty positions and leadership positions. While these questions and this representation can draw different stories across different societies, it can also draw different stories with respect to different institutions in the country, with respect to different disciplines in the country, And it could also be a very dynamic picture that is changing. So what we see a decade before may not be the picture that we are seeing a decade later. So I think one needs to sort of try to trace this along those lines, which may give us a better understanding of trying to unpack this very complex question of women, science and workspaces. So what does it actually tell you? Broadly, what it is indicating to us is the growing numbers of women in the STEM discipline. The numbers are growing. Yes, it's very positive. The numbers are growing, and so I think that gives us a sense that it's not very bad. What may be more important for us to see, where are the numbers growing? At what levels are they growing? In which disciplines are they growing? In which kind of institutions are they growing? And for me, the questions of the growing numbers is as important in an institute that is of national importance, though the number is small, because I think it gives you a bigger message than looking at the larger problem in terms of the constitution of women. So for me, looking at any of this in isolation does not give me the full picture. And so I think these need to be looked at together. Now, what is the story of women's low participation within this discipline? I would think that one of the main problems perhaps we are facing is we are using frameworks that's not allowing us to understand the problems completely. Whether we use frameworks that would tell you that it is societal frameworks that we use, use frameworks that say it's personal choices and family, I think each of these frameworks, while they contribute to your understanding of the questions of low numbers, they're not comprehensive enough for us to understand it. So can we look at evolving a framework that represents the field of women and science within India? Can we actually try and construct that from the data, from below, rather than use frameworks that are used either in the Western context or either used in a very limited sense? So that is one thing that I think becomes important. It is also important for us to raise questions of this whole thing that we would want to construct as the choices of women. Can we look at women's choices in terms of not as choices as you see it, but maybe as choices more critically? Why are they making these choices? Are these choices made because they know what it is? Do they know what are the choices they have, and is it an informed choice that they are making? Or are these choices that they are making with very limited information? And I think that becomes a very important point for us to look at. The other important thing I think we need to move away with respect to the research in this area is, as much as people say that bring numbers together or give us data, we don't want to look at small samples, it is very important for us to understand that when you don't know what the problem is, smaller samples is what that will give you an indicative nature of how the problem plays out in the field. So while we understand that indicative nature of the way in which one looks at issues of women and science, then I think looking at generating larger data becomes more easier. So I think we will need to use a combination of qualitative methods, generate your parameter, then try and see how do I generate this on large scale. And so if numbers is the only language that policymakers understand, if they claim that in science only numbers will talk, which I think can be contested very strongly, I still think that we will give them numbers. And then we will say, here are your numbers. Your numbers are telling us this story, but this data that I'm talking cannot be captured by your numbers. So I think we have to straddle on using both quantitative and qualitative measures when one is looking at it. More importantly, I think, which is becoming a very hard part, it's 10 years since I've been into this area, it's been very hard for us to try and understand what I would very loosely call the culture of science organizations. You are not given entry into that space. Okay? When you enter that space, you also will understand what they think they want to give you, because you are also talking to a very informed, intelligent audience. So when you go into these institutions, how do you understand the culture? And in a sense, I think the attempt that we did with Dr. Rohini Godbole and that's the Indian Academy of Science and NIAS, is to try and see, can we do this together so that we understand the perspective of how women within the discipline actually looks at the issues, and how does a person who has tools and trainings of other disciplines try and understand the issue, and how do we sort of merge the two. I think the fundamental issue of women and science in India is there has been very little conversation between the social scientists and the scientists. And for whatever reasons, whether it would be like how many of you all during your earlier presentation said that you give lip service, and so you involve them at a point, and then you move them out, or you give a sense and involve them, and there's little space for both of them to co-construct, co-analyze, and be part of it as equal participants. It is only then, perhaps, we will really be able to unpack the question of women and science within the country. Sociologists claim that they would understand the questions of women and science. They do it in isolation. You get one perspective. The scientists who also understand the questions of women within the discipline also try and do, and they do give you a limited viewpoint in terms of how the problem actually plays out. And I think it's very important not only to get both these groups together, but more importantly, involve men into this entire analysis, because only then it would be complete in terms of constructing your picture. By involving the men into your sample, involving their perspectives in terms of how do you understand this, does not defeat the purpose of trying to push the agenda of women. You're involving them simply because you need to understand their perspectives, because you know which way or what are your obstacles or what are the things that you need to sort of get over with. So keeping the conversation going, more importantly, rather than saying that we would be able to reach a point at which both of them would agree, I think keeping the conversation open is more important for us when you're addressing this whole question. I have 2 more minutes, okay? So I just, let me try and give you some sense, okay. I'll go to the last part of what I'm trying to look at. So one of the issues that we are trying to do is, we are trying to sort of unpack questions of perceptions. How does perceptions get unpacked in the larger thing? How does questions of belief of one's own ability guide and decide how you navigate your workspaces? How does navigating workspaces in different institutions, how different they are? And how those spaces are also very dynamic. It is not to say that when I enter an institute and I'm navigating and understanding that space, the space gets defined with people who are part of that institution at that point of time. The moment the individuals change, navigation of that space is very different. So I think it's important to capture this dynamism in terms of looking at workspaces and see how that can be addressed when one wants to really address this question. The final point which I want to just say is, I think it's important that, at least in our experience when we have spoken to women scientists, we found that women scientists who are much older are willing to talk about this. Is it because their problems are larger? Is it because they have found time to reflect and say, hey, there is a problem? Is it that the younger women have a different kind of problems that they are talking of because they have a different space? What are the problems that persist despite being younger or older in terms of workspaces? What are the things that has changed, not only with respect to the workspaces, but also with respect to you as a woman and you as a partner in this entire, this entire journey of getting, of trying to straddle your careers that you're talking of? Because I think today you have a lot of young women who would put it on the table and say, yes, this is what it would mean. So I will choose my spouse. I will choose the pattern through which I'm going to straddle work and life. And will this work for you? And all of this gets negotiated much earlier before they actually enter into the contract of marriage. And I think it's important to see these pointers and look. And finally, I would want to say, it's very important for us to document and analyze the positive experiences of women who have done it despite the difficulty, rather than look at the problems laying out there and saying that there's a problem out there. Because there are women who have done it who have navigated that space, who have done it differently and have done it well. Important for us to document and analyze it. Let me say this and stop.
Thanks a lot, Anita. Questions, comments? Anybody? Yeah.
I just had a question. You said that when we are in a stage where we still don't know what the problem is, that's when small samples matter. Can you just tell me why is it that small samples matter in this scenario?
See, when you look at, all of us in this room agree that the problem is very complex. And all of us know that the problem is studied with certain numbers. Now, certain numbers also have very distinct patterns in which these numbers are represented. Some of these experiences that got shared over the last few presentations, you won't be able to get numbers out there. So I think you should be able to put that out and then try and see what your numbers are telling you. And having said this, I think it's also very important to say that there are not many who would also give you these qualitative experiences that you think that they have to share, which will help you change the discipline. Because unless you're willing to sort of put that out on the table, it's going to be very hard. And this particular study that we did with the academy, we said that the data is with NIAS. And we said, no way you will be able to trace the individual who has participated in the survey. We will only talk of the categories that has emerged out of the data. And that's a fundamental principle that we use in social sciences, so that you are not able to trace back the person or the institute. Even if I have to lose out a data that becomes extremely important and would give me a fillip in terms of wanting to say what I want to say. But I think if it's going to be traced back to the institution or the individual, I'd rather not say it and not put it in the public domain.
Okay. Thank you very much, Anita. So as per the schedule, we were going to have Maitri Gopal Krishna come on next. And after that, we would have a short break and the panel discussion. But we've been delayed quite a bit. So I suggest we take a very, very short break right now just to stretch your legs, literally 5 minutes. And then we come back and then we'll have Maitri Gopal Krishna and then the panel discussion. So for the online viewers, we'll be back in 5 minutes exact. So there is drinking water outside. Tea and coffee is not allowed inside the auditorium. But if people are desperate, then they can help themselves. Tea won't be served now because this was just meant to be a short break. So there will be tea and refreshments after the panel discussion.
happens.
Okay, we're almost ready to start. Let me just check outside.
On this, is it?
Okay, we're starting. So we will now have Maitri Gopalakrishna, who is a counseling psychologist and a drama therapist, She also just submitted a PhD thesis to TIS on intervention research on sexual abuse of women. Maitri.
Thank you so much for having me here. I have one, I think. Am I audible? Yeah, great. Thank you so much, especially since I'm not a physicist and I'm a drama therapist. And what that means is that I'm a counseling psychologist, but the methodology in my work is theater. So I use role plays, I use scene work, I use character building, we use mask work. We use things like brainstorming in action, forum theater, if any of you have heard of Augusto Boal and his work. And so through the methodology of theater, we actually look at understanding individuals' psychology and behavioral issues to be able to intervene with them, but also understanding the impact of systemic issues on individual psychology and behavior. And in the context of today's conference or today's event, gender bias and gender inequalities and power imbalances are looked as systemic issues. But systemic issues that definitely have impact on the individual. It has an impact on the individual within that system in terms of how that individual is treated, in terms of what that individual thinks about themselves, so self-esteem, as somebody mentioned, in terms of what that individual thinks they are capable of doing, and consequently what they are able to do, also what they are able to do because of other structural issues, and therefore it has an impact on the field. Also, social and systemic issues such as gender discrimination have very clear mental health impact, including things such as depression, suicidal ideation, anxiety, and other such mental health issues. The good news is that systems are not stuck, but they can change. In fact, if I was to ask any of you, those of you that have been in the field 15 years or more, to give me an example of an institution or a group within an institution that has undergone a cultural shift, you'll probably be able to give me an example. There's two reasons why cultures shift or systems change. One is because somebody comes in from outside who's different. Normally, that person comes in a position of power. And because they are different, they bring that difference with them into an institution. I'm seeing some nods, so you're recognizing this. But also, systems can change and cultures of organizations can change from the bottom up. They can change through persistent action. And we have seen this also happen. Now, in both these cases, a certain kind of power is deployed strategically. Therefore, in my work, understanding power is very important. Traditionally, power is understood as a possession. Some people have power and some people do not have power. When it comes to gender, men have power, women do not have power. While this is not invalid completely because there is history and there is institutional and systemic power, it is still limited. And it's a limited understanding for the following reason, that none of us has only one identity. We are all made up of multiple layered identities. So let me take my example. While my gender identity is that of a woman, I am also upper caste. I'm also upper class. I'm also married. I also have a child. I also had a certain kind of family structure when I was a child that made me go through a fair amount of stigma. So when it comes to an identity where I have privilege, and somebody says to me, you know what, you shouldn't talk about this because you are part of a group that holds that power. I don't know what to do with that information. Well, it's true, of course, but what do I do? And that is another reason why looking at power as a possession is limited. Another way of looking at power is looking at power as a practice. In other words, how do I exercise my power? And this is where things get exciting for me as somebody who's doing interventions, right?
Let me suggest to you, next time you're in a meeting, and I know you are quite often probably in meetings where there are large groups, where you have had to be called, you have to show up there, and you don't really have much of a part to play. Yeah, does that happen from time to time? The next time you're at a meeting like that, I'm going to invite you to sit back and observe. Observe the way people exercise power with one another. The easiest thing to observe is what we call the power dynamic of power over. How do I have power over somebody? You will see it in terms of how people use their voices. You will see it in terms of how people use their bodies, people who stand up and take space. I was once in a theater in Delhi, and we were doing a show for the Delhi police, and this guy came in, senior police officer, and he stood there. And I stood there like that, and he said, "Haha, boliye Maitri madam, kya chahiye aapko?" He's calling me madam, but clearly, by the way he stood with his body, he owned that space. And he was exercising power deliberately, in my opinion, over everybody else in the space and me. Right? Power over something you can observe fairly easily. You can do this on a bus, you can do this sitting in a cafe. But there are other power dynamics, ways of exercising power. Another one is power to. And that is when people in so-called positions of holders, who are in possession of power, institutional power, this is a very useful dynamic. Because I can say, right, if I have caste privilege in this context, I have the power to do certain things, make certain calls, write certain letters, because not as much as on the line for me. I have the power, perhaps, as someone who's senior in the field, to call a workshop, to institute a group. And so this becomes one way that my position of privilege can be utilized to make the world a better place, a more egalitarian space. The third one is what we call power with, which is typically what the bottom-up movements do, where you say, individually, I don't have power, but with each other, we have power. We have collective power, which is why it's important for women to collect. Right? It's women. That's why women's groups are important. That's why the women within physics is important to come together as an entity, because there can be that collective power. It's called power with. And then there's what we call power within, which is this idea that internally you can have resources and resistance and power and be able to not just bear a system, but be able to make meaning out of it that helps you and perhaps helps other people around you. So this is looking at power as a practice. And so because, as you must have noticed, that I use my body a lot, and when I talk about observation, I'm talking not just of observation of what people are saying and how people are saying them, but I'm also talking about observation of bodies in space, right? In a meeting, notice when some person moves their chair back, a person in a position of power moves their chair back and allows something to happen. Until that person moves their chair back, the space is really not created for others to speak their voice, right? So why is theater helpful? Theater is helpful, drama is helpful, because within drama, we have a framework within which we can observe and analyze what is going on within us and what is going on in the space and in the bodies around us. Within theater, we can develop the tools that will help us practice our power differently. And because it's always awkward to try something new, within drama therapy, we can create a rehearsal space. So this new way that you want to behave in the world, you can actually practice it in this safe space. Try it out. What is it going to mean like for you to open up your chest a bit and have this conversation with your boss? I mean, as women, it's very hard to open up our chest. Yeah, we have all kinds of histories around our chests. But that's one of the ways power looks. And if I can practice it in a safe space, maybe 10 times or 12 times, then perhaps I can practice it in that slightly, I'm not so sure if it's safe space. So I've had the opportunity, actually, Shobhana invited me to go to the International Center for Theoretical Physics and work with women physicists. As part of a career development workshop for women in physics that happens there every other year. I've gone there twice.
And I've done two sets of workshops, and I'll tell you a little bit about one. One was called Challenges in the Workplace, and it explored what was the challenges for participants. And we did this all through theater. And these are all people with no theater background. They're all scientists. So I went in expecting people who were really, you know, stuck to their chairs. Nobody was stuck to their chairs. Everybody was happy to get up, and everybody was happy to play. So the challenges were a lot of things that have been mentioned today, right? Things like sexual harassment, not being listened to, experiencing microaggressions, stereotypes and biases, things that happen that close off opportunities, or being, you know, deliberately sidelined. The impact of these experiences were also explored. Things like imposter syndrome, feelings of inadequacy, immense struggle with self-esteem and confidence, including disclosures about much, much more serious mental health issues that I would see. Disclosures about suicidal ideation, anxiety, depression, and the ability to manage all of this, really taking away from time to actually do the work. And the workshops, not just what I did, but generally what happened at these workshops, seemed to give participants a sense of I am not alone. The fact that I am reacting the way I am is understandable given the circumstances. And there was a sense of hope at the end of it, which is that I can survive, I can subvert the system, I can resist it, and perhaps slowly I can change it. And most important to this was connecting with others. So people who had been the only woman in their department or one of two women in the department were now able to connect with other women, maybe not even in their own countries, but across the world, and could create a community. And through this community, there was power with. And through that, change seemed possible. So I was really taken by this experience. In fact, my thing leaving there was, wow, these are really remarkable women. I was like, Shobhana, are all like physicists so remarkable or what? And she responded and she said, you know, most of the women are really remarkable. And I guess to make it to a certain level in this field, you've got to be not only really good at your work, I mean, I think you have to be extremely good at your work, but also you've got to be really creative. And you've got to have a host of other kinds of skills, how to manage people, how to manage egos, you know? When you're put in the position, I know somebody was sharing how when anybody was feeling kind of low in the department or in the whole university, they were sent to her to speak, you know, because she was a woman. So she had to develop very quickly counseling skills, you know, or at least containment skills. So I can then refer you to a professional. So I was really taken up by the real sense of talent that existed. And I felt very fortunate to be part of that. And I feel very fortunate to be here. Thank you very much.
Just keep.
Let me begin by introducing the panelists from the extreme right. The first person is Professor Sulabha Kulkarni. She works in nanotechnology, and she is from the Center for Materials for Electronics Technology in Pune. Then we have Dr. Subhashree Desikan. Probably many of you know her. She is a science writer for The Hindu in Chennai. Then there's Professor Shobhana Narasimhan. She understands and designs nanomaterials. And she's from JNC, Bangalore. Rohini Godbole, she is a particle physicist from the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Professor Neelima Gupte, she works in a variety of things, including nonlinear dynamics, networks. She's from IIT Madras. And Professor Bindu Bamba, particle physicist, nonlinear dynamicist, University of Hyderabad. And then I'm Rama Govindrajan. I work in fluid mechanics, and I'm from ICTS here. So the topic for today is, we've already heard about the an overview of the situation as it is. The topic for today is how do we go forward, and we want to accelerate this going forward process by the title Pressing for Progress. And the question is, what can professional societies do? So how do we, maybe the format we can follow is that each panelist takes 2 or 3 minutes to make some opening remarks on what professional societies can do. Pardon? You want to start from here? Okay. You've been voted in. So then like each person makes opening remarks, and then maybe discussion between panelists, and then throw it open to the audience. So Bindu, will you start?
Well, I'm very happy to be here, but I'm a little bit disappointed. And the reason is that I am really old. And 31 years ago or 32 years ago, I had problems which I never thought that the next generation would face. And now I'm seeing exactly the same thing being repeated. And this really disheartens me, because we tried to work so hard not to have the young people face these problems, and now we see the young people facing the same problems. So we really have to do something to stop this. I mean, we really, it's about time. It's been so many years after independence, so many years since women in physics were recognized in many areas. They have been recognized as leaders, and it's about time that we started treating our young women scientists with a modicum of respect and dignity, and not make them face the same problems that we faced. And one of the things is that, you know, maybe we should project ourselves not only as role models, but as people who have undergone the same difficulties, and to give a message to the younger people that, you know, hang in there, it'll improve for you, but make sure that the next generation after you doesn't face the same problems as us, because it really is not, disheartening to hear this.
So Bindu, I'd like to take up your point, which is, have things changed and have they not changed? So I'll say some things have really changed. For example, I was just reminded when Reshmi, etc. were talking of how Rohini, Sumati, Jyoti Gyanchandani, Sunita Nair and I, we had gone through the 2002 IUPAP Women in Physics Conference, which was the first one. Yeah, keep it close. Okay. And that was really the first conference. And at that point, as Rohini and I discussed afterwards, after we came back, we said, we didn't even know that some of the things that we had encountered were examples of sexism. Okay. I mean, we were that blind. All right. So I don't think anybody is that blind anymore. So that thing has changed. All right. So this was, in that respect, things have changed. There is various initiatives which have come up, which various people have talked about. One thing I would like to say about the kinds of initiatives which have come up, I'd like to say something about is that things have changed for the better. So what are the things which are still lacking? So to me, there are 2 or 3 points to be made here. So I remember in this 2002 conference, we had heard Nancy Hopkins, who's a very well-known, very successful biologist. She was one of the members of the first MIT group on women in science, which is where all this started. I think it was in the late 90s or something. And she made the following interesting point. She said,
and there are other things which have supported it. She said people have said that what keeps back women often is family commitments, societal pressure, etc., etc. And so, but is this really true? So Nancy said that in fact, what she realized after talking to various people, that even people who had put their careers first, who had put their professions first, who had hardly any family pressures to speak of, they also had headaches. Okay. And I think Rohini et al. Had conducted a survey of young women in India. When was that one? Okay, maybe Rohini will tell you when she talked. Which said, what was the real problem that you faced? And especially this survey was conducted for women who didn't have jobs, women who were trained in science and didn't have jobs. And she thought the answer, and she said, so the survey said, why do you people not have jobs? And the answer they expected was family pressures. Okay. And the women categorically said no. Okay. The women said no, it was not the reason why they were not working in science anymore, was not family pressures. It was because they were not getting jobs in science. Okay, so there is something institutional here. There is a mindset here. Both, it's going all the way from MIT to India, and it's something which needs to be faced. One thing which I was talking to Prajval before we met for a few minutes before this program started was that this working group is meeting tomorrow. Will frame, hopefully, a written constitution and written guidelines as to what this group is meant to, would like to address. and I were talking just a few minutes ago. What to do when it's institutional, everything, finally, it's a case of women might have a problem. And so the place for women to go is within their own institution. And the institution usually has mechanisms. Nowadays, one of the things which has changed is that at least there are elaborate mechanisms in place, which was not the case years ago. But they also fail. They fail for a variety of reasons. What is to be done when these institutional mechanisms fail? Somebody from the audience brought up their own case, where essentially clear, it was clear that all the institutional mechanisms had failed. So what to do now? So it would be good if this group gives some thought to what to do when all mechanisms fail. The second thing is, I think people who have been involved in various situations where women have been put at risk, I think institutions often tend to protect them. The male peer group tends to protect them. Society tends to protect them. I would say women also tends to protect them. And we shouldn't do this. So that's all I have.
Okay. Thank you very much. I would really like to thank Prajval and Rama here to have organized. I said Rama because she's the local host. Prajval, because she has put in all the effort in doing it in ICTS. I would like to begin from where Bindu left. I would like to, and I rather agree with Nilima, that at least I find things have changed in a big way, that at least I have young women who are talking here about the issues when they are facing them, not 20 years since then. So that's the first thing. So I'm very happy at least that this has happened. And there is at least forum where we think that we should be discussing this, that this needs to be, that there is a need to address this issue. One of the things that I think this is for tomorrow's guidelines of, you know, what you people will do. I would, obviously, I think the issue of sexual or gender harassment, because the fact that these two are separate and that these both these need to be recognized and discussed is something that we have to bring this issue up. And I think if it comes through these kinds of groups, then it is easier for us to take it up at higher level, like UGC, which is trying to do actually a fair amount of work on this. But more important, I think, and I feel, is we need to make institutions accountable, not just for the harassment issues, but accountable to really make the work environment free of the invisible bias that we are talking about. And for that, one of the things, as some of you have said, and I am a strong believer of that, is we need to try and put in place something like Athena Swan or Sage, but of Indian variety in place. I believe our issues are the same, and at the same time, they're different. And I, for one, think, and that is not just restricted to women in physics. This is, in fact, that has been the story in India. I think even if we haven't had very active thing in terms of women in physics, but women in science, things have been moving. And there have been actions. And one of the things I feel, and since we are talking of pressing forward and what are the mechanisms that we want to put in place, I feel that we would have to somehow develop mechanisms by which we can put in place ideas for the institutions to follow guidelines. And that we have to figure out how way to institute that. We have to figure out. It's not a question of quotas. It's not a question of numbers. It's a question of atmosphere. It's a question of attitudes. It's a question of addressing. I think the most important one in the Indian context is precisely this invisible bias. That is perhaps far more important than your what kind of tests you use to enter, get people into the institutions and so on and so forth. It's the attitudinal change that somehow is the most important one in India. And I think we have to see how we can make scientific institutions responsible for doing this. We have to talk to the directors, the vice chancellors, and we have to really work it at that. So right now, this is all that I have to add.
Okay, I'll try to make it as specific as I can. So we still have a real vacuum of women in leadership. So the DST secretary last week put up a picture on his Facebook page. It showed the directors of all the IITs, the ISERs, ISC, etc., with the president of India and all the president's aides and officials, etc. There were 41 people in the photograph. Can you guess how many women there were?
One.
There were none, as far as I know.
ISI,
Sangamitra must have been. She wasn't in the picture, at least. There were none.
Okay, so Sangamitra could have.
Okay, so there were no women in the picture. So that's clearly very problematic. So I think one has to lobby for these things, and one has to point these things out repeatedly. If you lobby as an individual, it is not very effective. If you lobby as the working group of the on gender of the Indian Physics Association, you get some attention. Write letters in Current Science, write editorials in Current Science, write on the DST secretary's Facebook page. I did that. And he liked my comment. okay, so we have to lobby for this. We have to have women on committees. This is something about which the present government has made a special effort. In fact, they've done some rather remarkable things in this respect. For example, for the IITs and the central universities and the NITs, they can nominate, the MHRD can nominate generally 2 to 3 people on their boards of governors or their executive councils. And what they did was all their nominees were women. Okay, as a result of which these groups, which are typically are all male, now have women representatives. So I am now one of those people. So I'm on the board of governors of an IIT and an NIT and a central university. It is not always a very nice thing to be. It's sometimes a thankless task because people don't always take you seriously I mean, these people have clearly never had a woman on their committees before, and they are clearly not always very comfortable dealing with women. You're not always listened to, but sometimes they have to listen to you if you're on their board. And this is a good thing, but we should push for more of it. And also, they shouldn't put the same women on all the committees. There are lots of very talented women and experienced women in our country, and I don't know why they have put the same few women on all the committees. I'm on some 5-6 government committees right now. There's no need for that. It is also not fair to me, because I need to do my research also. So I think one thing we can look at is making a list of available women. Okay, that's not a very well chosen phrase perhaps, but but also that comes to the next topic, women in conferences. There are lots of conferences which have no women invited speakers. I think if we notice such a conference, we should ask for it to be boycotted. This has been done abroad, and those conference organizers have panicked and then done all kinds of strange things. They've said, sorry, we put up a preliminary list that was not our final list, and then issued a final list which has women speakers. I have certainly been on many conferences where I'm the only woman, and there are conferences where there are no women, and when I notice it, I write a note to the organizers saying, please notice you don't have any gender balance in your speakers. Again, it isn't very effective if I do it just as myself. It could be much more effective if you do this as a group. I think you should say that there should be no government funding for such a conference. Again, I think the IPA can have a list of available women speakers with their areas of specialization. I do know women speakers abroad who refuse to speak at conferences where they are the only invited woman speaker. And people say, how can you do that? How can you say it? But if they look, there are always lots of available, extremely qualified women speakers. People just don't think of them. So there's, in my field, there's a very well-known conference that happens every other year. And the organizers rotate. And last year, there were three organizers who were all women. I was one of them. And the way it works is the organizers give a short list of possible speakers, and there's a committee that votes on it. And we made sure there were lots of women on the short list. And then suddenly, the number of women speakers went up from about 10% to 35%. So there were lots of good women, it's just that people never thought of them. And when we suggested them, they said things like, oh, but she never comes to conferences. We said, let's invite her and see. And you invite her and she agrees. So if you just make an effort, you can get lots of good women speakers. And then the next year, it went down again to 5%. So you have to constantly keep pushing, keep pushing. Sometimes people don't like you for that, but you have to do it. Related to what Rohini said, I think we have all these accreditations and rankings of universities and colleges, which people are so obsessed with these days. They should include a gender component. The NAC accreditation, all these things, we should say that they should include what percentage of the faculty are female, what percentage of the students are female, what kind of facilities they give for their women students. This is certainly something we can lobby for. Okay, so this is something we should do. Then the other thing the IPA can do, I think, is organize workshops for women in physics, like the one that I've been organizing at ICTP. We would be very happy to do something like this, possibly at ICTS. I've talked to Rajesh Gopakumar about it. I know he's open to it. I think we would be very happy to do it. I won't take time now, but I'm very happy to discuss with people what are the goals of these workshops and what are the different components. And finally, I really want to say that
I think by now people are very well aware of what are the problems of women in science, and it's not like it was some years ago where we really needed to be sensitized about it. I think at least amongst women, we're very aware of it. We do need to sensitize men still, but nowadays there's so many meetings about this. In fact, I mean, like it becomes too much. Almost every other week I'm asked whether I will talk somewhere about women in science or attend some meeting about women in science. And now we have to move on to concrete action points. And we really should focus on very definite action points. And we should move beyond just talking. I mean, it's important to talk, of course. We have to share our experiences. We have to validate each other's experiences, and we all get very frustrated, and sharing our experiences is part of it, but we should also move on to the next step of actually doing concrete action.
Thanks to Rama and Prajval for inviting me here. I'd like to actually Neelima raised the question, what do we do when systems fail? So I'll give a few points on which I feel that this can be remedied. One thing is that the whole system, with regard to sexual harassment, we are acting as though the scientific institution is a closed family in some sense, you know. You don't seek help beyond. So just like a family values its honor and tries to keep everything within itself, which works against the victim, most often the women. I think that you need to take the help of media, which is supposed to be one pillar of democracy, and cultivate journalists and lawyers and understand the law better. Now this 2013 Act is here, but it's just been 5 years since it's been made an act. And it needs a lot of improvement. There are lots of gray areas which we've identified in this. Even here, we've been talking about it. But one experience I had is, there is one clause in the Act that says that the institution must file an annual report every year to a district collector, which is not being done by anybody. So collecting data is very difficult. So what I did was to send questionnaires to all the 38, not all of them, nearly 75% of the CSIR and DST institutions. There are 38 of the former and of the latter, and of the former and DST, there are some 18 institutes. So all of them I sent questionnaires, and only 5 replied of the CSIR. And those 5 were very trivially filled. Like when I asked, how do you select your members? Is it by election or nomination? They say, as per the government rules. And then when, how many cases have you dealt with over the last 5 years? None. It was like very happy places these are, where there is no sexual harassment, nothing happens. And there were places where I contacted people personally, and twice or thrice I called them pursuing the questionnaire, but still there was no response at all. So this kind of hush-hush thing is a great violence on the women who are being harassed, I think. So this is one point I wanted. Need to break out of this and seek help from outside. Secondly, I also, while writing some articles, I spoke with people from IITs and IASC and educational institutions rather than the research institution. I haven't spoken to universities. They are a totally different ball game. And in the IITs, I found that there was a slightly better system. People have actually taken action in many cases. IIT Bombay, IIT Madras have dismissed people and suspended people, and IIT Mandi also, I hear there are some things like that. So one thing is their experience must be harnessed. The other thing I feel about looking closer at it and also discussing it with a feminist friend of mine is perhaps the students have lesser stake in the institute as such. You know, when they become faculty, they're going to actually grab the space that is a male domain, and there is greater resistance from the system to those members rather than to students, perhaps. I'm not very sure. I'm not making a generalization of this, but we have a few data points, and from that it seems certainly that systems are kinder towards students than to graduate students, and maybe not. You know, there are always counter examples, but at least in some places it's working, and we need to see why those things work and probably get their wisdom. student bodies and networks of students from between institutes should be encouraged, and it should be actively promoted. Rather than in IITs, we've had some negative, in IIT Madras, there's been some negative things against the student bodies also, which papers have written about. But this should not be the case, because I feel the real fire is in the younger people. And the strength of the older and more experienced researchers is the wisdom that they've gained, and there should be a synergy of the two. And for this, there needs to be bringing in of students into the system, and in perhaps involving some men who are sensitized, and it should not be a purely woman's thing. These are a few points, and maybe we can discuss more when. Thanks for giving.
Thank you very much, Prajval and Rama, for inviting me here. I'm very happy to listen to all the talks and discussion that is going on, particularly from young girls, young women, about their present problems. Somebody was remarking that old researchers don't talk about their experiences and their problems they faced earlier. I must say that I was very fortunate to be in a place where we really did not know until very recent years what is sexual harassment and things like that. I was in University of Pune, and a student there as well as a faculty member. I served there for 36 years, then moved to ICER Pune, then now CIMET Pune. But my experience with University of Pune was that we had very free atmosphere and very good colleagues as well, I would say. And just even 2 years back, Pune University had all the science departments women head. So it is, I think, in a way, progressive and quite nice atmosphere we enjoyed. But in spite of that, of course, I agree with some of you that there are not actual harassment. We don't know when it is and what it is, but there can be derogatory remarks sometimes about you, and that, oh, a woman gets a very nice instrument. That kind of remarks I have also heard in my career. I never minded it. I just went ahead to prove that, okay, it is in safe hands, okay, and produce a lot of work. So that is the way I took it, wherever the remarks were made. But when I went to the conferences and some meetings, also some remarks from even IIT professors were made like this. I remember very clearly that I was in the synchrotron committee, and there were 40 participants, all at senior level. I was one of them, and I was the only woman there way back, I think, in 1990s or so. And then the professors remarked that, does she not have a home? Does she not have family? Does she not have children? Of course, I had family, I had children, but I managed somehow. Also, later on, there are some bitter experiences at national level. I will not talk about my own biography about it. But yes, you get experiences, but you have to still go ahead. This is a societal issue, in my opinion. And I would like to say that, okay, we are here to discuss physics and not society to large extent. But look at the way in which we try to do it. Even when you go for a birthday present for a girl and for a boy, it is different. You will choose a motor car or a toy aeroplane for the boy, and for a girl, always a doll, right? So that is the way we keep on doing it. And that has to change, unless society, now society also says that physics, mathematics, these are the subjects which are for men. They think that way, and it is not the subject for women. They should take always like soft committee, take soft subject like biology or something. I don't think that biology is soft or anything, but that is the way in which people think, and that mindset has to change. And even those women who are now in a position in some, like they are the in topmost positions in some institutes or universities or whatever, they have to also think that still, in physics particularly, the number of women is itself is less. Then we are talking from that 10%, 20% or whatever. So that number has to increase, and you have to start at a very school level also. Whatever the examples are given, not beyond Marie Curie we go. But there are many other women scientists. We have to put their examples. When you are drawing a picture on the textbook, you have to have women scientists also there, not just the men scientists. When you are talking about India doesn't have second C.V. Raman. Okay, C.V. Raman. But when you think of whether there will be another Nobel laureate, do you think of any Marie Curie again now? Or Maria Goeppert Mayer? No. We think again a man. That is our concept. That is our way of thinking that has gone. So that has to change a lot. Also, the number of women coming in science has to increase a lot. For that, we have to also work at school levels. We should go to schools and colleges, give talks, and also particularly emphasize that women can do, and they have to be taught like that, that it is not the science or physics or mathematics only meant for men. It is also women. Science is done for your, in the old days also, when women came for science, or when there were some women physicists who did excellent science, did not get Nobel Prizes and so on, but still they did remarkable science, and it was for the love of science they came in, and not for making numbers or anything that we want to have 20%, 10% or whatever. But those who are interested, they must come, and it is said by, I was told by a biologist that when you have the diversity in any species, then that survival of that species is more. Similarly, if you have in physics diversity of sex, that is men also and women also, then only you will progress. Your society will progress, your country will progress, your technology will progress. Unless you have women also in physics or in technology, I don't think we hope to make good progress. That is what I would like to say. And women scientists, just one remark I would like to make, particularly about DST Women Scientists program. Those who are taken there and given the fellowships and are they are given the projects there, why do they think themselves inferior? That I have never understood. They have to think them, they are in science, they are doing science, they are given the opportunity after career break. But many a times, I am very sorry to say, but I meet people, meet women scientists who say that, we don't have position, we can't do any progress. I know that it is for a short period, but so are Inspire fellowships also. So they have to make the good advantage, take the advantage of whatever the opportunity has come to them and progress, try to find their own place in science. So that is what I would like to say here. Okay.
Thank you, panelists. We are running late today. So we have a very quick remark by Rohini, after which we throw the thing open for questions.
Sorry, because this was something very much in my mind. I think one of the this is a suggestion to the working group, in fact, is that we need to think of some procedures or some statement which we get out about what about the people who have been so-called convicted, is too strong a word, against whom cases of misconduct have been proved. The question is, what is the attitude of, I mean, one thing I feel, and this is my opinion, that such people should never be hired in a position of authority again. Other things, you know, you cannot say that excommunicate these people from science, but question of position of authority can really be asked. And I think that could be really a very concrete recommendation, which is goes beyond just the punishments.
So in the case of some scientists, Wikipedia has also made this amendment and said that the person is a disgraced scientist, you know. So that is.
OK, Okay, we'll now have questions. If you have a question for a specific panelist, please mention that.
I just wanted to hear, nobody in specific, but anybody who wants to answer this. So even when it comes to awards, everybody knows that there is a huge skew in the number of women scientists who get awards, Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar being the classical example. But there was a trend-changing Infosys Awards that happened this year where there were 3 women and 3 men. And what I noticed is that all the women, all the science awardees who won the Infosys Awards were Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar awardees. So this is not going to last. They have maybe 5 more in the list of SSB awardees who they can award in the next 2 years. So, in fact, we even asked the Infosys people here, are you taking any conscious effort to address the gender gap? And they were very dismissive, saying that no, we only went by merit. And I just want to know your views on, is it impossible to get a more evenly awardee list?
To answer that,
awardee answer or boys club, the awards group also. But I think one of the things that the working group can address is the fact that there is something called the Matthew effect. Those who have get more, and basically what happens is that once you are in the spiral of success, you just keep on being pushed ahead. But the women who have been relegated to not entering that spiral, they need that extra impulse or kick from the outside. And perhaps one of the ways of doing it is to, I really liked Shobana's suggestion, for example, when women are, when you have these conferences without women speakers, just boycott those conferences or put out a call for an official boycott of that conference and, give women the kick you want. When you get into power, when women do get into power, they should actually show some compassion and also some recognition of women. They should not say, now I got it made. I am part of the confederacy of self-seekers. I've sought and gained, and now I will not help the rungs from which I have climbed.
No, I think there is a point to some extent in the one point that she made. I think it is also the responsibility of women, quote unquote, many of us sitting here or who are not sitting here, but who are there, to be very aware and alive to this issue. And for example, personally, I can tell you that I try to see if I am nominating for different awards or different prizes. I would try to see if I find one person, I say, is there also a missing a woman? I mean, that is something that one has to do. That is not going to be enough. And one thing I can say is that you have to keep on making the noise. Bringing it, noise is not in the sense of making, just din, but noise is making in the sense of bringing it to the notice again and again. And I can tell you here, I can quote a personal experience that the cost, please, I apologize in advance for what I'm going to say. In the Indian Academy of Sciences, I was the first woman in physical sciences to be elected a fellow. And in Indian National Science Academy, I was the second woman in physical sciences. And the point was that when I said this, that they're not women, people first said, oh no, of course there are. Of course we can see. And then one had to take a book out and read. So I think given that, in the 20 years, things have changed. And I think in the matters of the kinds that you are talking about, the change has to come only like this. Because indeed, finally, we want meritocracy. That is there.
Okay, let's move on to the next question because there are several questions. And then we can come back to this point if possible.
So, mine is not a question. So, I think Prajval, in the beginning of her talk,
made a comment that often in the community, women who are proactively championing equity and, you know, reduction, you know, these gender gap issues are actually accused of being that, oh, you know, these people have not done enough insight. I mean, this I have heard myself, targeted against women who are actively talking about the women's cause. And this is extremely, I mean, they are questioning the academic credibility and all the. So is there a way to, how do you, I mean, this is just a, I don't know if it can be done at an institutional level or, but how to address these issues? If, because you have senior experienced people in the panel, because this is extremely offensive when you hear such comments about your own colleagues. Sure. I have heard.
I mean, I certainly heard it a lot. And every time I do it, I mean, I almost do it hiding sometimes, like nobody knows I've come here. It's terrible, okay? At some point, you just have to decide, I don't give a damn. If I believe in this, I'm going to do it. I don't care what they think. But I think the only way it ever is going to get credibility is when men start saying it. So if enough men talk about it, then it gets respectability. As long as women talk about it, it doesn't have respectability. Yes. Yeah, yes. Yeah. Yes. Exactly. Yes. Exactly, exactly. That's what I think.
You have a question?
Can I say something on this also?
Yeah.
I feel that informal groups with students, including both male and female students, should be
encouraged. Male and female faculty, and not even one man showed up. But when I did it with students, lots of male students showed up. Yeah.
Even here we see a few. Here we see few of the wrong gender, so it's good.
One comment I wanted to make was that, especially when it comes to suggesting speakers or anything like that, I've noticed that it is automatic that women think of it, whereas the men don't think of it. Yeah. Okay. So generally, if you have women on organizing committees and so on, the number of women speakers whose names are suggested automatically goes up. I've noticed this many times.
Okay, so I have a question regarding the sexual harassment thing. So I want to mention a particular case where the girl complains before ICC, and after 6 months or something, she get a report in which it was written that the accused person, it was proved that he was guilty who was accused. But with that report, the accused goes to court. He challenges the report. And day by day, the thing days passes, but nothing happened because the legal proceedings took very long time. That time, the student regularly has to go to different legal person. But unfortunately, she faces that legally, in the eyes of law, she gets very less hope of winning the case or proceeding further or something. But she has to, but she have to fight in front of court because a writ petition has been filed against her or something. So days passed on and nothing happened in either I court or either institute, nothing has happened. Means, so what is the, then what the girl should do? Again, she faces that some of her fellow friends who supported her and make some protest, the accused person filed writ petition against her friends also. The friends who were supporting that girl. So means then they have also to, the friends have also to go to high court. They have also to go, instead of their studies, they have to go to lawyers, legal persons. So means in this situation, what, how the girls would proceed, or what is the thing? Means
wondering whether the girl can also ask the institute to hire a lawyer for her, a good lawyer.
Yeah, she can ask the institute, but hire a lawyer. But when she finds that the institute, the lawyer the institute have given, that particular lawyer goes to the court and admits that, yes, we have done mistake. Instead of fighting against the, means instead of fighting, she finds that, I mean,
That's
how could the girl should trust the institute when the girl goes in front of director, that I want to talk with you about the person. I want to talk with you personally about the thing, about the problems I am facing or something. Director sometimes tells that I don't want to talk with you. Sometimes he tells that it is sub judice. We cannot tell anything. You go to ICTS.
This is an important thing you brought up. And yeah,
I'd like to respond to that. See, I think one thing we have to face very clearly is that the law is in very nascent stage. It's a very gray thing. It can be interpreted in many ways. It's not at all giving any solace to the victim at the moment. And also the ICCs are also a new concept relatively in many places. So it's not encouraging. But what I think is that this that survivors of such sexual harassment acts should actually be very part of integrated part of a student network, and you have to contact your own lawyers and be aware of these things.
When the fellow students are protesting, then they are also being accused.
Yes, I understand.
Petitions were filed against them also, so they have also their careers, they have also their studies.
Yeah, what I'm trying to say is that as a journalist, I can say that you must probably explode and take it to outside agencies.
No, Subhashree, this is where the institution is failing.
Yes,
okay, and that is what I meant.
Media, have you gone to the media?
Direct proof, but they are. We can understand the institute is protecting the accused or something, but we cannot.
It cannot be changed. I think that is the present state. I think we have to face up to the fact that it is in very bad shape now. And
I think institutions try to protect their name. That is the first thing. Yeah, yeah. But it is happening. It is happening that way only.
As a practical thing, maybe have they tried writing to the National Commission for
Women? National Commission.
Yeah, but I want to say National Commission for Women is not a guarantee of anything. We had tried to seek their help when we were encountering similar issues in our institution, and there was only reciting of what is the, you know, the law and that sort of thing. There was nothing, they were in nothing interventional that they were willing to do. So it depends on the local, on the respective. Yeah.
So could the working group, as one of the things, could you have you could actually have lawyers that you could look, who could not who could be there for information and who could suggest options. And so if people are going through issues like this, and it sounds like people are going through this in different institutions across this country, sometimes you need help from outside. So could they write into the working group, and then could this be a sort of a resource that's available to them?
So the working group at the moment has no funding whatsoever. So it would be, you know, quite beyond our bandwidth, you know, to do anything like this. You know, as it is, the work we do is very much on the side. It's sort of like how what Shobana said. Often we have to hide and do it, you know, all of that. So that is not something I can see happening realistically in the near future. But what I could possibly see happening is we could possibly, you know, have some sort of charter, for instance, that we have on our website, saying these are the best practices, you know, sort of a thing. And then persuade institutions to sign on to that charter. So, for example, we have zero tolerance for sexual harassment. An institution should say on its website, we have zero tolerance for sexual harassment. You might say that words don't mean anything, but once an institution says that on its website, they are more accountable than if they did not say it. I mean, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Physics group actually at least points this out. It's that gives you the handle to take it forward. And I just thought I received an email from Ram Ramaswamy, who was supposed to have joined us. And I thought since it came exactly at the time this was being discussed, I thought I should read out parts of his mail. This is showing an example what the institution and the academicians can do if they want to help the quote unquote the victims of sexual harassment. So he says, I'm just going to read the beginning few lines just to give an idea. That, dear colleagues, as you may know, JNU is in the grip of yet another crisis, this time because 8 women have filed police complaints about sexual harassment against a powerful professor. Many scientists from within JNU have already shown exemplary solidarity with the complainant's quest for justice, and some of us have drafted the short statement for endorsement. Please circulate this among colleagues, etc. We could circulate this so that people see the statement. And since we are just discussing precisely this topic, I want to show you, as she says, things are in a state of flux. People, this is a new thing. People are trying to come to grips with it, how to handle it. But the fact is that we are at least now beginning to realize that it has to be handled. And this is very nice, so I thought I should just... I will circulate that mail.
Can I make a very short comment? Since in the Act itself, there are lots of gray areas, so can, from the working group or from some forum, it can be suggested that there are these gray areas and it needs some amendment for us to fight for the cause. Mm-hmm.
Universities that have had fairly powerful committee, and they have dealt with some of these cases, and they have done it where there are resistances of this kind. I think it will be useful to try and see if that can be documented and shared, not completely verbatim, but what they did with specific steps, and that could be shared with a larger group, because this is a law in the making, and so it's important to see how some of them have tried to get over it. More importantly, I think even the constitution of this committee and getting your external person, it's extremely important that that's not taken lightly. Because if you can have a very strong constitution of the committee at the institutional level and have a legal expert, which many of us think we are busy and we don't get into that, I think if that can be put in place, some of these issues may be able to be addressed. You may not get it in this form. But I think you will have to use a combination of ways of doing it.
So so far in our discussion, if this is just something I thought we didn't address, we've been assuming that, you know, we're united in our efforts in this lobbying against the discrimination we face. But what when women themselves are hurdled against other women, progressing? For example, I spoke to this professor just last week, and he has quite a few women students under him. A few of them have got assistant professorships. One of them is a male, he's one of his students. And these people got, there was a conference in Toronto, and they all got an invite. The male got a, the male student who was not even an assistant professor yet, he got a mail saying, dear, Professor Shankar, and so. And all the female students who were, much senior, who had already had assistant professorships, they got, dear Miss so-and-so, dear Mrs., And they came and told them, aren't they supposed to be writing doctor here? And then he checked what the others got. He checked what his male student got, and he wrote to the director saying, this is shocking. How is it that you... And the director, in all truthfulness, he was supposed to know about this, but he didn't. And after, going through this matter a little bit, he found out that the secretary who sends these mails, and this have... And she's not somebody who's new to the job. She's been promoted from some other department, and she's come here, and this is being propagated, and, this has been happening over the years. So how do we address this? Are we assuming that we're united in our efforts in this lobbying? And if not, right? Yeah, there are... Yeah, even though they're not ego clashes within the same hierarchy, I understand that. I don't know if that happens too, but maybe you would know better. But this is such a petty
issue. I've been fighting a battle with one of the institutions where I'm on the board of governors. I've been fighting this battle for about 2 years now, that they do not address my mails as Professor Miss Narasimhan. And I say I will not sign their minutes anymore. but they simply do not understand. They really don't understand what the complaint is. And it's just been an ongoing battle. And they're all highly educated people.
Right.
And so
but if they're addressing the males as Professor so-and-so.
Yeah, I mean, why don't you write Professor Mr. for them? But they really don't understand.
Totally.
And then they finally removed it from my name, but they put it against all the other women's names. And when I said, but you're still doing it, they said, but we removed it from your name. So they really don't understand.
It's a petty individual battle, which isn't.
Yeah, I'm not very sure if it is a question or a suggestion, but I would like to share my perception based on an experience I had as a faculty in undergraduate level when I was teaching at a university here in Bangalore. So the major issue that I feel in the whole scenario is not at much higher level of the institution and universities. Of course they are. But also at a much lower level, as Professor Kulkarni mentioned, that things need to be sensitized at a much younger age for men and women, the boys and the girls. And the sensitization also should happen to the parents and grandparents, because parents have a very high influential authority on the children's mindset, and be it boys or girls. So I, as a faculty, have seen this in many cases when we used to sit for career counseling, especially. We suggest something that the child or the student takes, but the parent says, anyway, the girl is going to get married. Why should she go further up and study so much? A normal BSc course in life science or physical science is sufficient. In a couple of cases, I have rudely replied to the parents, telling they have a very disgusting mindset. And I've been screwed for that by my university as well. But I think if the working group can come up with programs for school levels, maybe talks or like one of the speakers said, through activities like theater activities, sensitizing school children or at least adolescents and parents, I think plays a very key role for the future generations also. Thank you.
Yeah, that was actually one of the things I would wanting to talk about also, is that you start, the working group should also establish contact with NCERT. So that in the textbooks that are written, there are, you know, images of women doing physics, you know, and so that the girl student can identify with a scientist, and the image of the scientist for the girl student should be a woman, you know, not necessarily that it's always, you know, Einstein looking person with flowing white hair, you know. You should, a lady in a sari can be doing the same science as the Einstein looking person. So we did some analysis of all textbooks that are studied at the undergraduate level, and we found that except Marie Curie, as she said, there was absolutely no woman represented in there. And I think that should change, definitely. So maybe the working group can address this.
So I just wanted to say about awards that I have very mixed feelings about awards.
The Marathi book about women scientists just published this month. It is about women's struggle, and from 400 to 1900 something, or 2000. I think Mirzani was the last one.
Yeah, I just want to say I have very mixed feelings about awards that are made specifically for women scientists, because they're meant to encourage women in science, and I myself have received some of them, But I think the danger is once they have these awards, they give those to the women and they think, oh, she got that. So she doesn't need the awards that are for the general category. So I really don't know what to think. I'm a bit confused about these kinds of awards.
Would anybody like to say anything before we conclude?
I think, again, the same problem with number being less. Okay, if you look at the nominations for the awards, you'll see that if there are 30 nominations, there will be one or two maximum women at a time. And if they are not competent enough, you can't say that, okay, push this women. That's the problem. So you have to have large number. If there are 50% nominations, then there is a chance that you have a woman, Bhatnagar Award in physics also. So far, there is none, isn't it? You all agree with me? Yeah, there is none for any physicist woman. Okay? Yeah.
Last point by Rohit.
No, I do agree. No, I will. Yeah, nominated, how many? That is what I'm saying. So the number is so less, and they are not the best then. Okay,
we'll have a last very quick point by Rohini before we give the mic to Prajval. Very quick point if you want to make one. Okay.
I was going to make a
tangent. Okay. So, I think many valuable points have been raised here and I hope some of them get converted to action points. So, I will now give the mic over to Prajval who needs to say something.
I'm not responding. Okay, so I just wanted to say in conclusion a few words of thanks. First of all, to ICTS, of course, it's their program, and they were extremely willing and supportive. It's not just a matter of, you know, being willing and supportive to have this program. It's also a very strong message that as an institution and the institutional leaders here are committed to this issue. So that's very important for us. I also want to say that it so happened that all the people, you know, who speaking on the dais, etc., were all women. And just by luck, the men who have taken very strong roles in this whole effort were not there. Rajesh Gopakumar, director of ICTS, was on travel. Dinakar Kanjilal, president of IPA, who has been a pillar of support, he couldn't come. Ram Ramaswamy, who has been with us right from the beginning, and in a sense, even before we began, also was not able to come. He was there online, but he was not able to be present. So it wasn't really, I mean, the men were there. There were some men who are really committed. It's just that they happened to be not present. I just want to thank all the panel members and Rama Govindrajan for coming for this, just for a half day program. It really means a lot. And of course, all the audience, thanks for your time, and the speakers, Anita and Maitri, particularly, for sharing perspectives from outside our discipline, which I think we badly need. Thank you.
And a big hand for Professor Prajval Shastri.
So there's tea and refreshments outside. Please help yourselves. And chit chat as well. For those of you who need the transport, the next bus out of ICTS is at 6:40.